Well, everybody but Gemma. Gemma actually found a store, right? Or something like that.
Mari.
Right.
Yeah. That was a couple of sessions ago. Mari made the potent potables store, and it's been doing pretty good business in spite of the recent turmoil that has plunged the city into darkness. So, Mari ought to roll a wisdom check to just see what the performance of the store has been. See if little street urchins, little mini Maris, haven't carried off your profits.
Seven.
This means that the store hasn't earned much of a profit for you. You're barely clearing your overhead.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, it's just for fun for me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let's see here, but it does make a very good impromptu base of operations for you guys, and you are gathered in the potent potables with your ice lad guard dogs standing sentinel over the entrance.
Yeah.
I love how much Thus hates that thing.
It is disgusting and entirely unnecessary, and we really should kill it as soon as possible.
It's a noble small creature.
It just stands obediently at attention and just kind of winks at you, Thusk, and just goes. It's brain pulsating inside of the plexiglass case that is over its cranium. You guys are sitting in the potent potables. Catching up after you guys have been off on your own projects for some time, and you have a guest. There's a person outside of the trading post, even though it's not office hour. It's not open. It's not store hours.
Who is it?
You wander over to the Dorthusk and you glance out of the tiny port window there, and you can see it's Priest. He's an old man, and he's wearing black robes, and he's got black eyeshadow and little trails of tears going down either of his cheeks. He looks all strung out and kind of deranged.
Don't let the promise be dead. It's from the university.
It might be a Jehovah's Witness. I don't know. It's hard to tell.
Some god.
It's a customer. Come on in, sir. Come on in.
Just gonna stand out of the way.
Mari,
you look like
as you
use some
open
tattoo
the
remover.
What's that?
As
you look like you use some tattoo remover. Please come in. I'm all sore.
Pour some waterproof mascara.
Yeah. As you open the door, Mari, you discover that it is your old acquaintance from the first adventure in Agartha. It is the old priest Dullahan. Mm-hmm. He was the old man being flogged by Armos Camaratha's son, Arendal.
Mm-hmm.
He's gone through a considerable wardrobe change since the last time you see him. He's in black regalia that's a strange inversion of the priestly robes that you first saw him in. And he smiles warmly and he says, "I'm very glad that you've decided to let me in."
Can I roll wisdom, insight? Whether he's turned to the dragon, is he like wearing regalia of the shadow dragon Typhos?
He's quite frank with you. He says that when you met me, I was a priest to the dragon above, and now that the dragon above has arrived to claim his city, I am doing my duties, and I have acquiesced to all of his commands, and he has commanded me through prophetic dreams to come reach out to you.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been speaking to you in your sleep.
In what regard?
Typhos has learned of your activities within the city, and he thinks that it has been too long since he's had a too much time has passed in which he's had an opportunity to meet with you. He's extended an invitation to the Citadel so that you may meet with the dragon above yourselves.
I'm going to kind of shuffle around behind the priest, raise one hand, and give a questioning look at Mari.
It's just a pawn.
No. Emissaries have protection.
Right, right. That's, this is how we treat our messengers.
Thusk, you can see that
linked with the people they worship. Nah. Sorry, what?
Thusk, your warlock abilities allow you to perceive the faint magical auras that surround Dullahan. Certainly he's saturated with Typhos's evil magic, but they are not powerful auras. Dullahan is not exactly a threat to you guys by himself.
Is there anything scrying in nature? Divination? What does it smell like?
You sense that the dragon Typhos is using Dullahan to be able to view through his eyes.
Yeah,
you can sense Typhos's presence through his chosen priest. Our prophecies foretold his coming for centuries, and now that he is here, it is time for us to place our plans into motion.
Wait, Typhos is claiming to be the dragon above?
Yeah, I'm going to whisper to these guys.
You guys all look
Typhos
up.
Typhos can see us.
Yeah, you guys all look out the windows of the potent portables, and you can see the alabaster citadel of the city towering up above you in the skyline. And you can see, almost in response to your guys' craning your necks, you can see the enormous black wings of Typhos extend from his perch high atop the citadel.
You tell your master that if he wants to see us, he can come himself.
Dullahan nods his head. He says that although your response disappoints me, this has not been unforeseen. And so, if you change your mind, I will be collecting alms in the plaza. Please, please come to me. I feel that there is a way we can serve the city and end this internal strife for good.
For good.
Mm-hmm. So Dullahan sees that he is not welcomed, and he beats a hasty retreat.
Right. So the dragon wants to recruit us.
I would go chat with him, but...
Yeah, I'm more surprised we've spent a couple months and not tried to eliminate his other sergeants.
We can work on that now.
We really should be working on that.
John, did you guys both read Tori's email with the ongoing events?
Some of it. Skimmed it. I'm checking it. I'm rechecking it right now.
I saw that the influx of labor has cast out the demi-humans.
Yes. Well, the Lifter's Guild is not exclusively demi-humans. They're just made up of a large contingent of the minorities in the city. Many of the Lifters don't even speak the common tongue, so their guild looks out for their interests.
I'm Bill Garza. They don't even learn the language. Take our jobs. Break our women.
I mean, one of the things I was thinking is, we've been killing a lot of our enemies. I feel like we should go and try to negotiate with Desiree. How was she originally making the residuum before she went all genocide happy?
The Ouroboros formula for residuum is a jealously guarded proprietary formula, so it is not known to people outside of her clan.
Excellent.
I thought we had, when we got into her office, we found out she was sacrificing people.
Yeah. That's how she's making the residuum.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's the way it always was.
Yeah. They're just rendering down people.
Hmm. Well, she was utilizing an abundant resource in the form of displaced refugees. Before that, you're not exactly certain what she was doing in order to produce and meet her quotas.
I think we should convert her. I think we should probably win a vote.
No, we should definitely kill her.
I think we should probably kill her.
Humanity for which she must have.
This is rendering down people for residuum. I'm pretty sure we should kill her.
Maybe for the rest of her life.
You know, we could go to the other one and see if maybe we can convert him.
Nilzen?
Nilzen is the one that's starting the gnoll breeding program. We could try and convert him, but...
We do have a handful of gnolls still, right? Or was that 24 hours?
It was just 24 hours. I mean, we could do it again, but... Yeah.
Maybe render gnolls instead of people.
Either way, she's committed horrible crimes against humanity.
We could go try to kill the dragon.
It could be she was using gnolls before the influx of refugees, too.
I would point out that trying to kill Typhos at this early stage would be ill-advised because his power level is disproportionate to you guys at this point. You need either a killer ally or some type of tool or some type of information that will level the playing field if you wish to fight Typhos.
Like an awakened world tree.
Right.
The world tree wouldn't hurt, but even that by itself would not be enough for you guys to level the playing field.
Chris, why did you ask if we had read it or not? Is there something that you saw that was important?
No, I was just curious, like, discussing what we want to pursue.
There's a fleet coming in.
Yeah.
Good. We have a lot of displaced workers that we have to rally.
Arcos says he has presents for us. We'll go get presents.
And then kill Arcos. Yes, we should do that. What? Yes.
Why are we killing Arcos?
Because he's breeding ice lords.
No. Okay. Priorities. We may
because need Arcos them. Needs to die.
We may need those to repel the invaders surrounding us on every side.
Or we could rally the refugees instead. He's not exactly because he's breeding abominations.
But how do you kill the gorillas?
The what?
They die in the winter.
That's right.
What? I missed that.
Essentially, it's just a problem of creating a second problem for later. We could use the slots, but it'll just create a slot problem later.
Right.
They'll die in the winter, John.
They'll fix themselves.
It's true.
Please listen to the warlock when he tells you about the problems with using abominations beyond reason. It's generally a bad idea.
Hey, we let you join the party.
I'd like to point out. Just as an omniscient voice from the narrator up above, that you guys have a problem of having so many different options and very little information. What you guys lack right now is information regarding what the correct course of action would be, and so you need to seek out resources in order to inform yourselves.
Yeah, we're talking about what resources we want to seek out, I guess, right now.
There's always,
yes.
What's her name, that princess we saved? Mika.
Arcos can probably give us information.
There's a lot.
Arcos is totally into Desiree, so he probably has been keeping tabs on what she's up to.
That's true, I forgot about that.
We've
got Gearweaver, too.
Arcoth is more into Desiree's corporation than he is into her. He wants to hostily take over Clan Ouroboros.
Yeah, I'd rather find out how to deal with the necromancer.
Nilzen? I think we could just go and stomp on him.
I like the idea of capturing him for kind of some first-hand information about
Typhos. Oh, we could do that.
Because I feel we weakened Desiree last time, so we could go after her while she's weak and let Nilzen get stronger. Or we can go after Nilzen while he's strong now and let her get back to a normal level.
Yeah.
I'm happy with either of those courses of action.
Should I vote for Nilzen?
Yeah, that is a problem we're going to have to solve, and it seems like it's fairly self-contained, so...
So who would have information about the forest things? Can we go see that druid? And his gay tree?
What?
I guess it's not a gay tree. He just had a relationship with a tree.
What druid?
The druid that has sex with the tree. You know...
Yeah.
Maybe, oh, Theron. I've got him written down, yeah.
that's correct. Nilzen has an opposite. He has there's a peaceful elf that lives out in the Druid's Grove near to the crater. He might have information regarding his wayward cousin.
Okay. That's not a bad plan. I think we should go talk to Arkoth and get presents first.
Okay.
Presents for us.
All right.
Okay.
Maybe it'll be another slot. Who knows?
I'm hoping so. Maybe it'll be a bigger one.
Catch them all?
Yeah.
Like a death slot. Everyone needs a death slot. You think that Arkoth has little jingles for these things? It's slot, it's big, it's brutish, it's evil. Every family needs a slot, now with instant cleaning power.
You can do the laundry. You can drop the kids off at school.
So are you guys going to visit someone? Are you guys going to visit someone here inside the city before you leave, or part for a destination outside of the city?
Sounds like John's against Arkoth. I'm okay with going to Arkoth.
If Thuskis is against visiting with Arkoth, then let's just go straight to investigating Nilzen and follow up there.
So, to the forests.
To the forest. Follow me, my friends.
See here, I need to close some windows.
All right.
Because I'm getting...
One second. We could try to take some of these guys and just threaten their lives, and then...
Poor guys?
The EO guys. We could just threaten their lives, and then if they are willing to submit, force them to submit to a Geas.
One second. I'm managing my task manager here so I can free up some extra computer resource.
Yep.
I'm getting some stuff here.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Okay. I hate how reliant on coffee I've become in the last week.
Oh, I love it.
No, it's terrible.
So good.
It's so good to wake up feeling like death. And then realize you need at least 2 cups to, like, at least get out the door.
Yeah, you gotta put fuel in your tank, man. You gotta
Respect yourself.
That's the exact opposite of what you're doing. You're putting more than fuel. You're putting like you're like putting nitrous oxide in the tank, and your car's not gonna be able to go that fast. So the more you go fast, it's gonna be like damaging to everything else. Your suspension's getting shot because you keep putting in the nitrous oxide.
You can go so fast though.
Yeah, I know. I know. Now I can only go fast. I need to go fast, man.
Is that any better for you?
My computer is running at 100% CPU for some reason, and I'm trying to figure out where the error is taking place. Something is consuming a lot of resources, so I'm hold on while I pare everything down.
Do you want to restart? That might be your best. Might as well do it now before we get rolling rather than record anything.
It might be if it
gets worse. Hold on.
And it frequently runs a virus scan right as you start out. Sort of thing.
It's the worst possible time to run that.
Yeah, okay. No asshole.
Okay, I've pared down every unessential process, and so that's as good as it's gonna get. So I'll just make do with it. I've got a brand new internet connection, but I think the problem is with my computer right now. So it's disconcerting. Anyway, so you guys depart the city of Agartha.
Tori.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry, I wasn't sure if we could hear you or not. You were still talking?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead.
This will be difficult because anytime the two of you guys speak at the same time, then my computer has a little conniption. So we'll have to try to work the gas pedal, the brake pedal on this, because I'm having a little difficulty hearing you. Anyway, you head out into countryside surrounding the city, and the first thing that you see as you exit the city is smoke coming from the Nilzen's tower.
Having a barbecue.
Mm-hmm. Imagery similar to Saruman's castle in the Two Towers. It's definitely a great deal of activity taking place.
Oh, is he mustering his horrifying null army?
Or the dragon that was between them.
Mm-hmm. At this time, you guys suffer from a lack of information, and so there's no way to tell what the smoke represents at this point.
Do we keep going to talk to the druid, or do we check out the tower?
Let's keep going to the druid and see if he has any ideas.
To the druid!
Mm-hmm. Well,
I hear he's only half druid. A druish princess.
Yeah, one of you... You guys... In order.
John Harden, do you have an opinion? I can't hear you. Can anyone else not hear John?
I can't hear John.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I lost John too. I can't hear him. No, nothing.
Everyone loves a John.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to use the restroom real fast, and I'll be right back.
Hey, can you hear me now?
Yeah, there you are.
Alrighty. Awesome. I have no idea what happened. Alright, so we're going to talk to the druid, right?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. I am in agreement with that. Because Burning Tower doesn't sound like a good thing to just rush into.
Mm-hmm. Agree to disagree.
Sorry, Gemma, but it seems like a bad idea.
Yeah, not all of us have fly-ins that we could just ride into battle with our Holy Avengers.
I mean, I can't cast fly and everything, but I still think we should be smart about this.
That is true. We could just fly up to the top of it. Just go, we're here, bitches!
Boom, right on the top.
I mean, speaking of... So I do have Windwalk prepared. you end up to 10 willing creatures you can see, assume gaseous form, become a cloud. And while you're a cloud, you have a flying speed of 300 feet.
Wow.
300? Holy shit!
In about 3 hours, and you can take 1 minute to switch back to your normal form or back into a cloud form.
I'm fairly certain that once we go talk to the druid, it'll be like, it essentially is a teleport back to the tower then.
I mean, we could do both. We could use it as a way to get to the druid very quickly.
Oh, sure.
Oh, that too. How long does it last?
8 hours.
8 hours?
Yeah.
All right, yeah, no.
Why are we even fucking walking? Why are you just saying
I don't know. Why are we using these two stupid things on the end of our legs?
Yeah,
this, is like that scene in Dumb and Dumber where you take off your gloves. You're like, you have a second pair of gloves the whole time.
My hands were cold.
Good. Fire. Then yeah, it's probably worthwhile to get rolling. So yeah, I circle everybody up and into my chant and turn us all into clouds.
Awesome. Yeah.
I'm
okay with this.
Okay. You guys turn into clouds and fly over the landscape, and you completely circumvent the prowling displacer beasts that I intended to ambush you with. You can see them. You can see you pass harmlessly up over the displacer beasts sitting.
Yeah, you're cutting out pretty bad, Tori.
You might try your video.
Cloud forms descend.
Maybe you can't hear us.
Yeah.
That is worth a shot. I'm going to switch off my camera.
Yeah, maybe John, too.
Wait, you can't hear me anymore, either?
No, I can. It's just, it's because it's just resources. Does that make sense? For all the computers.
Okay. Awesome. There we go. Any better, Tori?
I can hear you guys okay right now. Hold on, I'm tweaking things here. Let me.
You're coming in a little bit clearer now.
Yeah. Seems to be helping, certainly.
Yeah, it's it's not necessary for me to broadcast video to you guys, so let's see here. Save.
Theater of the mind.
Oh, shit. No, that was not a good idea. Yeah. Hold on. Okay, I'm out of ideas to improve the stability of our connection, so I'm going to just work on it like this.
Yeah, it sounds like it's much better now, so that's fine.
It does sound better, yeah.
I finally fixed my frickin' internet, and now the computer's giving me problems, so if it's not one thing, it's another.
Oh, yeah.
You guys descend into the Druid's Grove, and you can see there are several bystanders there. You can see were-tigers, were-boars, and were-bears kind of watching you timidly from the edges of the forest. But as you descend down into the center, and you can see the big marrow tree that Theron is married to. And he's sitting in repose with his legs crossed in front of him and his staff, like, stuck into the ground beside him.
What are the were-beings doing? Are they waiting for him to... Are they kind of milling about? Are they...
They're watching intently from a distance. They know that none of them are enough of a threat to you guys to be able to contribute to the scene. But I'm just mentioning them to let you know that Theron is not alone in his glade.
Mm-hmm. They're not threatening him. They're there as allies.
Yeah, they're just gonna hang out with him.
Yeah, they are citizens of the Grove.
I kind of go towards one of them to see what's happening, as opposed to interrupting whatever he may be doing right now.
Oh, okay. You can see three varieties there. There's a were-tiger, a were-boar, and a were-bear.
I've always kind of seen myself as a were-bear, but I don't think I've ever talked to a were-boar before. So I'm gonna go to the were-boar.
Choice. You approach passively and inoffensively as you can manage. Roll me a charisma check.
Oh, that's something I have none of. Cool, 15.
Hey, there you go.
15 is a success. You can see that although the werebore is disturbed by city dwellers' presence in their sacred grove, he gives you a chance, and he transforms into a very shaggy humanoid form. You can see he probably has some orcish somewhere back in his ancestry, although he's to all apparent appearances, he's mostly human. He nods to you passively and says, "How can we help you, travelers?"
There's been much unrest in the city, and apparently there's been much unrest here, too. We've come seeking the druid's advice, but he seems to be busy. What is he doing?
He is communing with nature. He is sojourning his territories surrounding this area, making certain to protect us from gnoll incursions, which have been frequent as of late.
Go
ahead, John.
Can we ask him some questions about those gnolls? Or would you know anything?
How have your lands been affected by these creatures?
Yeah, I thought they died down lately, a couple months ago.
We do not have permanent structures or many resources that the gnolls care to come and plunder. So we fend off their minor incursions whenever they make appearances. Truthfully, we are just riding out the storm and waiting for the humans of Agartha to go extinct of their own stupidity.
All right. Task gives him a salute. Good job.
Go.
Yeah.
Are you not worried about inheriting the problems of the city once they have gone as the prey?
We believe it. Theron has told us that the fire will burn itself out. Once Typhos has claimed the souls that are vulnerable to him, he will travel on and continue his dark quest through the lands. And he will look us over because we are not vulnerable to him the way the citizens of Agartha are.
That seems like a bad thing to bet on.
Theron is mistaken, my friend. Agartha is but the tinderbox that will start the whole forest aflame.
Yeah, talk to him.
Sure about that. Yeah.
Can I roll insight and see if there's any question I should ask? Is that how I can use insight or wisdom for a gut feeling?
Well, sure. You can also roll knowledge checks too in order to massage more information out of me.
Mari is not a smart person. Mari is like above average intelligence, but more wise. More goes with their gut than anything else.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if someone else has intelligence, this is an area for you, sir. Dude. But what are we persuading him to tell us? You know,
yeah, that's more. I am sure.
Specificity trumps generality in D&D, so... I've given you as much general knowledge as I can realistically give you, and I'm withholding all the specifics.
I think we need to speak with Theron once he's finished with his little dream quest there.
Yeah.
Your party has approached respectfully enough. If you were to rouse Theron from his trance, we would not be offended by you. You appear to have come to us as allies. As long as you maintain this appearance towards us, we will not draw first blood.
We do believe we have something important to offer, but we could use your assistance. Let us rouse your master.
Let me slap him. I am wearing gauntlets.
Don't do that.
is he your master?
Sardin, you go and poke him.
We wild things have no master. We defer to Theron in times when we require leadership. This being one of those times, certainly. He is older and smarter and wiser than all of us put together.
I don't know. He married a tree.
The Mari kind of looks like a tiger and kind of like. Do you like to approach again, or kind of if we approach the group?
How about we let Sardin go over and poke the tree?
Yeah, go ahead. Go do the thing. I was just,
yeah.
That red tiger looks like a fastidious, a ferocious hunger, or hunter. Definitely an ally.
Yeah, the werebore shows you over to his stores, and he brings out a jug of forest moonshine, and he does his best to extend hospitality to you guys, while Sardun goes over to the center of the glade underneath the maru tree.
Sounds good. Awesome.
Yeah, the old elf's eyes alight, flutter open as you approach Sardun, and he nods. I know why you have come, but I am afraid that I might disappoint you.
You're shooting us down already? Why is that?
That's a hell of a way to start.
You haven't fallen to that horrid dragon's clutches as well, have you?
No, indeed, Typhos is anathema to all things living and all life itself. No, I fear that you've come to ask me for my help against my cousin Nilzen.
We have.
Oh, well, there's that
too. I'm afraid that I am no match for Nilzen, and I have not been a match for him for centuries. The only reason that I am still here is because he does not perceive me as a threat any longer.
What has he done that has made him so much more powerful?
He used to be a rogue and warrior of some repute, but when he discovered his talent for necromancy is when he went off the deep end, so to speak. And since his alliance with Typhos was founded, his power has only grown exponentially.
Great. You're connected with these lands. You know what he's up to right now?
Yes, he has raided the countryside for every farmer, villager, merchant, traveler available, and he has captured them and relocated them to his tower to be used for spare parts in his mad experiments. He's decided that gnolls will be insufficient for his siege of the city of Agartha. And the only way, then he's trying to supplement them with more heavy siege equipment in the form of his undead abominations.
Blood hoax.
Yeah, we're going to have to kill him too.
Yep. Well, you kill everything in the tower and then...
We're drinking moon.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Nilzen is almost 1,000 years old, older than I, and he has patience in abundance. He will not throw his forces against the city willy-nilly. He will wait until the people of the city have reached the zenith, the maximum of their hopelessness and disarray, and then he will strike when they are weakest.
Yeah.
Sails from all sides. Do you know anything? Does he have any weakness? Can he be approached on the scene?
I believe that this might be the best way to deal with Nilzen, because facing his army is foolhardy. There are hundreds of gnolls still, and now he has only augmented them with his undead abomination. So if you can think up some clever way to circumvent the armies that are gathered outside of his tower and simply infiltrate the tower where he hides, that would be what I'd recommend if you had such a skill. He's cut down all of the trees near to the area, so I'm unable to help you with tree stride. Normally I'd suggest, just take a step right in through to his backyard through a tree. I could have done that for you, but he's aware of my influence, and he's taken appropriate precautions. Nothing living is within a mile of this tower.
Is the tower boarded in any other way? Do you know?
I do not know what skills and profane abilities Nilzen has acquired. It's no doubt that he has some form of security there, but the specifics I'm not privy to.
You said you and your people aren't willing to lend us aid, though?
My abilities are stretched thin, trying to protect the few people that I've gathered here in my grove. I fear that your presence here will draw the attention of the rebels of Agartha. If they were to learn of my aiding you, then it might have incredibly harsh repercussions for my people.
This is the problem with you old druids. You think the world will just pass you by if you sit here in silence. It won't.
Is that a persuasion?
Yeah,
roll persuasion. I'll say that's DC 17 because Theron is very committed to his strategy of sticking his head in the sand.
I got a 12.
12 is... Yeah, Theron says... The shorter-lived races do not know of the cycles that this we must go through. Typhos is no stranger to these lands, and neither is the Crystal Palace. These things have been here for longer than humans and dwarves have resided on the continent.
Well, change is coming, and we're going to get out ahead of it. Do the rest of you guys have any questions for him, or?
Do you know what the inside of the tower looks like?
Nilzen's tower? No.
Yeah.
It was built long after our falling out.
Damn.
Have you been tracking the actions of the gnolls? Have they been doing anything suspicious? Have they been attacking villages and taking back any certain resources?
They're after people. More than they are after food or weapons or things of that nature. They are after living, breathing bodies.
Live.
Even wildlife, deer and bears and whatnot, everything is caged and chained and shackled and dragged to the tower to be dismembered.
He's building deer bears.
Where's the largest concentration of gnolls that are not at his tower?
His eyes flutter shut for a moment as his senses extend through the roots of the trees and grass throughout his domain. And he tells you that there are 25 gnolls that have just gotten done reaving a small settlement of refugees that got tired of the city.
There's no more than that.
They're not far from here.
I'm looking for probably bigger numbers than that. 25 is okay, but, I mean, how many are at the tower?
At the tower, there are at least 100.
Okay, well, that's okay. 25 is probably fine.
Yeah, there are at least 100. My abilities to count them diminish towards as I near to Nilzen's sphere of influence.
Does his power increase at night? Does attacking him during the day affect anything?
No, Nilzen just prefers to operate at night. However, he is not at any sort of disadvantage during the day.
That's just one of those necromancer myths you hear, you know.
Not all necromancers, John.
Do you know anything about that smoke?
The smoke is from his war engines. He's melding flesh and steel and bone together into siege engines that can defy the walls of the city of Agartha.
Is the smoke toxic, or is it just, smoke?
Well, it's toxic smoke, but it is of little concern compared to the ravenous hordes of undead beings that are underneath it.
I'm wondering if it'll affect our cloud forms.
No, I do not believe that it will.
Okay. Anyone else?
I'm dead.
We're gonna...
All
right. I think that's about it.
What about, would you, I know that you won't help us, would you put in a word for some of these allies of yours to help us?
They should stay out of it as much. I do not command any of the people under my protection. If you wish to recruit some from their numbers, you'll have to do so yourself.
Well, I understand. I just put it to work. Hey, yeah, this guy's pretty cool.
Volunteers?
Gemma?
They respect you. Would you ask them if any of them would volunteer?
He comes with you guys, and he grants you advantage on a persuasion check to interact with any of the three were tribe leaders.
Cool.
All right, who do we want to talk to?
Gemma's going to, like, do a rousing speech.
Mm-hmm.
Military-esque about their protect home and country and forest and whatever. Kittens or whatever they have at home.
Yeah, all of the three tribes that are present are not necessarily allied with each other. So you'll have to approach them individually and make your pitch to them individually to choose which ones you approach first.
Oh, go to the Imakandi first. I want the Weretekkers. They're all good in their own ways.
Alright, so that's for the Weretekkers. 18 plus...
18 plus 7, so 25.
Ooh. Is that a persuasion check?
That's what I did.
Okay, alright. 25 for the Weretekkers.
One second here. Let me just pull up this info that I have on my computer. One second. Okay, the Weretekker chieftain, a very stout woman named Hildi, tells you that the Weretekker tribe are not many in number, but you have our support as long as it's not some type of suicide mission, and Hildi herself will accompany you guys if you need her expertise and teeth and claws for a mission.
Alrighty.
Those are our scouts.
Sounds good. What are the other two?
Yeah, so
what are the other two were tribes?
The werebears and the wereboars.
Okay. I'm gonna head over to the wereboars.
Okay. It's the same guy from...
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the same half-orc from before, and so you can go ahead and make a persuasion check, and Theron does his best to reassure them that you guys have good intentions, and he grants you advantage.
Alrighty. Is it just him there, or are there others of his tribe there as well? Am I, like, talking to just him, or talking to everybody?
They're all there, but he's the only one willing to treat with you. The rest of them are way better deferred to him.
Right, chieftain. Right. Okay, I'll just take this to anyway. Hey guys, who wants to go pull apart some gnolls? 20.
20 is a success. Excess is the name. He introduces himself as Excess. He's the chieftain of the Boar clan. And the Boar clan is much more numerous than the Tiger clan, although they are not necessarily as powerful as the Were Tigers. He says, "Yeah, our meager forces are at your disposal, and if you need me to join you for a mission, I will join you."
Awesome! It's gonna be great.
Mm-hmm. We have manpower in abundance. If you need something torn down quickly, we can definitely do that. If you need something built, we can also manage that, but much slower.
Right. Well, we're assaulting the tower, so it might well come in handy, just tearing down it anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Unfortunately, stone does not yield easily to tusks.
Mm-hmm. But there are doors on the tower, so.
Mm-hmm.
We'll find something for you to do.
Yeah. There remains only the reserved and quiet Bear clan. Findor is the chieftain of the Bear clan, and he sees you guys coming at him, and he's like, he's already disliking this.
Let's do the talking. You want to do it with us? I think yours is slightly higher than mine.
It is. It's one up.
I'll lend you an arrow.
All right. I'll do the talking, I guess. Just not sure what to say to him. How do you reason with reasonable people?
Yeah. The Bear Clan sees no reason to die for the people of Agartha. The people of Agartha fear and hate us and kill us when they get the chance.
But you've also been having troubles with the gnolls lately, correct me if I'm wrong. And that's only going to get worse the more you wait.
Bears do not fear gnolls. I resent your presumption.
But it's not just about you, is it? It's about the Imakandi and the boars and everybody else in this forest. You gotta look out for everybody, right?
You would say that the bears do as they please, then.
Hmm.
The bears fear no man. No gnoll.
Yeah. Theron contributes as best he can, reasoning that you guys are no pushovers yourselves, and that you've proven yourselves against the gnolls, and he grants you advantage to try to...
Let me tell you a story about the last time we ran into a whole bunch of gnolls. I tell them about the last time we ran into a whole bunch of gnolls.
Yeah, he struggles to subdue a smile, a grin on his face, and he says, "It sounds like a glorious battle."
27 total, yeah, persuasion.
The bear clan will be present for any conflict you require us for. And Findus will accompany you on any mission that you need him on.
Findus?
Mm-hmm.
Alright, that's everybody.
I have some ideas.
Yeah, it looks like a plan now.
Yeah, we should actually have a plan.
The Rat Clan and the Wolf Clan are not present. They are going to be much more difficult to rally to your cause, and they are much more numerous and powerful than the three of us present here.
Rats and wolves, huh?
Yeah, the Rat Clan and the Wolf Clan, they are forces to be reckoned with, but they do not come to for the protection of Theron the way that we do, because they are capable of handling themselves.
Right.
We could just go beat up the Wolf Clan leader and become the new Alpha.
I'm not... Is that how it works? I don't know. I don't want to presume anything.
So how it works in
well, Yeah, the Wolf Clan and the Rat Clan, they are not so susceptible to persuasion as we are. They are not exactly rational.
What do you mean, not exactly rational?
they obey the laws of nature, and they relocate when a greater force is about to fight them, and they attack when they've got a smaller force in front of them. So no amount of charisma will help you win them to your side. You will have to, or intellect, you will have to bribe them or force them in order to cooperate. Carrot or stick.
If we're going to be slaughtering that many gnolls, there's going to be a lot of carrion there. Rats might like that. Mm-hmm. Don't know about the wolves, though.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if that's...
Is how major of an assault are we making on the tower? Do we just need a distraction so that we aren't swamped by an army while we slip in by other means? Or are we assaulting the gates?
Well, I figured we were going to, like, fly into the top of the tower, and an assault on the gates would help us get in unknown sort of thing.
Yeah, or at least just keep the army from coming to the gate once.
Right.
Engaged with him. Which, using the board bears and tiger is to just kind of...
provide a distraction.
Yeah, provide a distraction and bait them out away into the forest, away from the tower.
That'll work for their small numbers as well. They don't have to, like, really engage, just... Swift attack, run away.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, this is, do you guys say these plans in earshot of the three cap chieftains that you've recruited, or are these secret inner circle discussions?
I'm fine with bringing them in on the planning.
Yeah.
What's the plan so far? That's my idea, sorry.
What were we thinking? An assault on the tower is a distraction while we slip into the top in gaseous form.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. Okay. But we should. Did you guys think about taking those 25 as a distraction?
I was thinking of that too. Yeah, we could enslave them to our will. And
well, what and, I think we could do is take those 25 and instead of like using them as shock troops, maybe use them as drawing tools. So like to take those 25, get them to the 100. And then convince them there's a larger threat that they need to respond to.
So take the 25, tell them to go back to the tower, and somehow demoralize the other 100.
No,
or to like to take the 100 and walk them somewhere else.
Oh!
The humans are attacking to the left. Come with us.
Or that there's a cluster of humans that they need.
Yeah.
Yes.
The one weakness with that strategy is depending on the deceptive capabilities of a bunch of gnolls.
Uh-huh.
Well, once they're under our sway, can we convince them that it's true?
Well, their loyalties will have switched, and so if you give them the command to deceive their former allies, then they will... they will have to roll with a minus one.
Right.
Excuse me. The other thing they could do is go back, integrate into the rest of the Nilzen, into the rest of Nilzen's army, and then when the little guerrilla raid is launched, turn on their allies.
Yeah, that might be a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Hildy chimes in. She says that... any plan involving the skill of the Gnoll's deception is doomed to failure, but if you were to nab those 25 that are raiding the hamlet, you could easily pump them for information regarding the placement of Nilzen's forces and the weaknesses of his fortifications.
Oh, sure.
Well, that's true, too. I hadn't thought of that. Mm. Yeah, we can do that. And then ask them to go back and integrate and then turn on their allies. Yeah.
Alright,
yeah.
Are we going to go after the werewolves and were-rats, or no?
Mm.
Let's do one of them. Let's just go for it.
I like the idea of were-rats, maybe? I don't know.
Gemma is not into the rats.
No?
I know how to communicate with the werewolves more than I know were-rats, so that'd be uncharitable territory. It's up to you.
What use are mice when we have the cat?
Oh, we can try the wolves then. I don't know. Either way.
Rats are good too. Everyone hates a tower full of rats, right?
Yeah, I was just thinking they could get in pretty easily if they wanted to. I'm just not sure how to convince them.
Right, they're the infiltrators. They're
Yeah. Wolves, however, would be fighters, I guess.
I feel like our bears are the shock troops. Wolves are the soldiers. They're like the SS, you know.
Yeah. Well, they're naturalists, so none of them have very specialized roles. All of them kind of fall into their take care of their own and are well-rounded forces by themselves.
Sure. Right.
The weretigers are not numerous. They do not have more than a dozen. The bears are only slightly more numerous. They do not have more than two dozen. And the boars are quite numerous. There's like 50 of them all squealing around the hillside somewhere.
Okay.
Yeah. I feel like the tigers are best used as like scouts and or hunters. So like we give them a single target. Like you guys need to take out the general of the forces, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Bears are like the siege weapons. You know, we need you to take out that wall. And the boars are good shock troops as we have them, I guess.
The boars are good at dying en masse. That's one thing that they're very good at.
Gotta have a skill at something. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's see, if we had rats or wolves, we would outnumber them by that point, because we have almost their numbers as it is.
We will if we have that 25 as well.
Yeah. Oh, that's true, yeah. If we turn the 25, we'll...
So we could just do it right now. So that's the other thing.
Yeah. Yeah. But if you wanted to try for the wolves and make it overwhelming...
Mm-hmm. We don't know what's in the tower.
The thing is, we don't have to overcome his army. We just have to take his army out of the picture so that we can deal with him.
Right, exactly.
Yes. The more numbers in the distraction, the less allies we lose, I guess.
Let's make a decision. Do we want to go after the wolves? Do we want to go after the rats? And then let's go do it.
Do you have a plan for going after the wolves? Because I'll get to admit, I have no idea.
I like Jesse's idea. Fight the strongest.
Oh. Yeah, we can try that then. Yeah, let's go try that.
I think that's a Gemma job. Gemma, you ready?
It is.
Cat beats down on dog.
Cat on dog. There you go.
Oh.
Okay. Theron points towards the setting sun. You will find either the wolf and the rat tribe have fled to the western lands farther away from Agartha and the tower. So you will find them out that way.
We better head that way then.
Let's give some standing orders to these three to rally their troops and meet us. Yeah, kind of like an intercept between the 25. Should we go get those guys now?
How long does the compulsion on them last?
24 hours, I thought.
Eight. The rod of compulsion lasts 8 hours. Yep. Rod of rulership.
Mm-hmm.
So we better do it after we get the wolf tribe.
People are dying, tribe. In that village.
Oh.
It's alright, let's go get some wolves.
Yeah.
Let's make a decision. Action time.
Go. Yes. Yeah.
So you head out to the west. The group of you head through the forest, and you bid farewell to the druid Theron and his allies.
We'll use our cloud form, so we'll just kind of...
Sweep away.
You can maintain concentration on that, right, Sardun?
It's just ongoing. You don't even have to concentrate.
Nice. That's
a really badass spell.
Yeah. You guys just disappear into a poof of water vapor and then take off out over land. And I'll say that the bird's eye perspective grants you guys an advantage to the survival check to track the packs of werewolves.
Oh, I can do that.
You're surviving?
Yeah.
Yes. I don't have ship as well.
I get a 14.
14 is not enough to turn up. You figure...
Even with advantage?
I got a 4. I got a 1 and a 4 on my
board. Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. You search...
Oh, yeah, great.
You search for a full day, burning up the whole duration of your cloud form, and you'd think a substantial force of almost 50 werewolves would be easier to track, but you find nothing but spore and picked over bones of their prey animals.
I don't know, guys. It seems like they don't want to be found. They're more skilled than I would have expected.
What do we... Tie a deer to a tree.
You guys would have the option of making camp here or returning to the city of Agartha.
I mean, we can camp in the grove. It should be relatively safe there.
I'm fine with camping in the woods. Maybe we'll wrestle something up. Mm-hmm. Out here. Maybe we'll be bait ourselves.
Yeah, I can take watch.
Alrighty.
I meditate.
Okay. Yeah, you guys sleep the night, and while you are sleeping, Mari watches over you protectively. And Mari, you can see a deployment of 4 shambling corpses off in the distance. They are about 1,000 feet away when you notice them, and they seem to be being drawn to your guys' encampment.
Oh, great.
Did we pick up any items?
I don't think so.
All right. I wake up the party. You said 1,000 feet away. Prepare range spells. Are they big? Are they medium-sized?
They're human-sized, wearing hide armor and impressive helmets.
Impressive helmets.
Gemma was her holy avenger. Like, gleams in the night.
Yeah. Do the helmets look magical? Can I see any auras around them?
At this range, you cannot detect any auras. You must get within short range in order to perceive
right.
Magical auras.
Damn. Squinting.
All right, let's prepare an ambush.
Yes, right. You guys ambush, and I will sit here on my lion with my glowing sword.
Thusk, your ability to perceive magic does allow you to see a glowing ethereal eyeball that is scoping you guys out inside of your encampment here.
Oh, god damn it.
You deem that it is likely that Nilzen is using a spy, some type of clairvoyance, in order to direct a small detachment of his undead forces towards you.
Well, I can dispel this and we can move, or we can just kill him.
Gemma's very excited about killing him.
Do you want to tip your hand that we know that he's watching?
Oh, well, that's true. We can leave him wondering. And then get rid of it when we need to.
Right.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, let's just kill him then.
Yes!
Did he just notice this, or has he been following us for a while? Like,
Apparently just noticed it.
My question would be, because your eyesight's always on, right?
Yeah, Eldritch Sight is always on.
So it could have been.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
So it must be for sure.
Because if it's a recent development, he cast it during the night, found us, and then is sending them now.
Mm-hmm.
And it protects us from necessarily him seeing our interactions with the druids and those folks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh no, it's actually I can cast detect magic at will.
Hmm.
So it's not always on.
Yeah.
So I'm not quite sure if this has been following us or not.
Hmm. Cool.
Hold detect magic. Yeah. So I'm not sure.
Prepare yourself. Prepare.
I really should start doing that a lot more often.
Mm-hmm. The shambling corpses close to a distance of about 500 feet They are marching hurriedly in a beeline straight for you guys. It is clear that they are not randomly happening upon you.
Yeah. Should we just get ready to kill them?
Yes.
Alright.
Mari keeps her eyes open for anything else that might be approaching.
Mari, roll me a what's your passive perception?
19.
Yeah. Your passive perception reveals that the shambling corpses are accompanied by you see that their limited shadows revealed by the moonlight are spasming disturbingly in their footsteps. You can see that hiding inside of the shadows of the shambling corpses are separate undead entities that are laying in wait for their opportunity for a combatant to come close to them.
We have
so there are not four opponents here. There are eight.
Mm-hmm. Oh, jeez.
The sand people walk single file to hide their numbers. Bari tells the party that this is a bigger encounter than it could be. It might be beneficial for us to. No, it's just gonna happen. This fight's gonna happen either way.
Yeah, this is happening.
Yeah,
we're gonna smash him.
Yeah. But it will, so maybe hold back your most powerful things just so that, you know, Nilzen thinks that we're weaker than we are, maybe.
Okay.
That is very hard for me.
Yeah. Mari
calm down.
Mari does her best to point out the malignant shadows that are clinging to the revenants. However, their passive stealth is the DC of their stealth is 16. So unless you guys have a passive perception of 16 or higher, you just have to take her word for it.
Right. Well, I've never known Mari to be wrong yet, so, or at least not willingly.
as they're approaching, when they get to about 120 feet out, I cast Fall Lightning.
Okay. They can perceive you, so that would start an initiative roll.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Okay.
Can I just go to a tree?
Oh, definitely. You can scale a tree and place yourself up and out of the tallest tree is 40 feet.
And I'm going to prepare my light bomb. I have a, what do you call it, a vial of crystal dragon breath from my store from way back.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Essentially just like a light bomb. It's a flashbang.
Right, right, right.
Very, very good. Just one second while I grab my dice. Ooh.
Alright, I'm going to try not to use any spells.
Don't use your highest level.
So we shouldn't turn into fire elementals?
I never
said that. Try to resist the urge.
If necessary.
Darling, would you grab me that pen right there? Mm-hmm. Not you guys.
I thought we were your darlings.
Well, that's disappointing as hell, Tori.
Well, you guys are my darlings as well. There's a ranking system of darlings. You guys are only just one tier below the darling. So let's see here. So I'm going to roll for my revenants, and then I will roll for my shadows.
Oh, that's right. We're rolling two.
Okay. What are your initiative rolls?
Nine.
Sorry. Mari, what's your initiative?
Nine.
Gemma, what's your initiative?
19.
Sardune, what's your initiative?
Nat 20.
Nice. And Thusk, what's your initiative?
9. Mario probably has higher dex, yeah.
Yeah. So the monsters act last in the initiative. All of you guys can act in whatever order you want to in order to start the fight. Right. So Sardun, you're starting it off?
Yeah, I'll cast when they come into 120 foot inside 120 feet, I'll cast Fall Lightning. And start crashing that down on them.
Is Call Lightning an area effect spell, or does it pick out a single target one at a time?
Let's see. It is a single target.
Okay. You have four visible targets to choose from.
I'll just start picking on the Revenant in front.
Okay. Revenant 1.
And he gives a dex save and throw to DC.
Yeah, his dex save was a 9, so he fails and takes full damage from the lightning bolt.
He takes 21 points of lightning. Nice.
You blast him, and you can see as he's necrotized by the bolt of lightning that it singes his skin and that it almost immediately begins healing as he starts stomping forward relentlessly. As the bright flash of lightning illuminates the battlefield, you guys can see the drawn faces of fallen dragon knights who died trying to protect travelers on the road. They've been brought back by Nilzen's magic.
Okay.
It's Gemma's turn.
Yeah, Astride my lion. I'll have my lion dash forward so that I'm in melee range, and then I'll attack the same one.
Awesome! You close to melee with the front row of Revenants.
Does a 14 hit?
14 is not enough to hit them as they are clad in the battered armor of their order.
Wasted all my good juju on my 19. All right, that's my turn.
Oh, you know what? I was wrong. It affects each creature within 5 feet of the lightning strike.
Okay, they are slightly spread out so that they are not vulnerable to a 5-foot splash. They're about 10.
Hiding in their shadows.
Oh yeah, the shadow one is hit by your lightning bolt. He must roll save and throw as well. He gets a 17.
Fails.
So he takes half damage?
No, he failed.
Oh, he failed. Okay.
Yeah.
So he takes 21 points of damage, and he has damage resistance lightning, so he takes 10.
Oh, okay.
So after that, Gemma closes in and takes a slash at the first Revenant, and it bounces off of his plated armor. Mari, it's your turn.
Mm-hmm. I didn't expect her to charge forward, so...
All right, she can dodge.
I guess, yeah. I will... how far can I throw an object?
I would say you can throw it a number of feet equal to 10 times your strength.
Okay. I will.
I don't know what the actual limit is, yeah, but that sounds like a pretty realistic.
Sure, I was thinking like 30 or 60, so 90 is good.
yeah. Yeah.
It's acceptable.
What?
Nothing.
How about a shadow step 60 foot to to the top of another tree? So I'm 60 foot away from the park?
Yeah, there are trees about every 25 feet away from each other, so you'd have ample opportunities to relocate out onto a branch 60 feet closer. That's about 60 feet away from the formation of revenants that are gathered in front of you.
Yeah, and I'll throw my potion of crystal dragon breath into the midst of them.
Okay.
You know, margin of error being, you know, one body, so 5 foot or so.
Okay. I'll say that Is there a specific mechanic for how that item works?
I think that we have written it down at some point, but you know, it's there. You know, Matt, like, what would you think? Like a fire dragon, like if a red dragon breath was there, would it be? It'd be like radiant damage, in as opposed to fire damage, right?
Okay. Well, sure. Yeah.
Radiant damage.
Yeah. I'm not sure how grenade weapons would work in this scenario. Hold on, let me crack the DMG. There might be some suggestion as to how to handle this. Okay, let's see here. It's relatively analogous to a modern grenade, like a fragmentation grenade that does... that does what you call it, radiant damage. So you pitch it. Oh, I see. It says a grenade has a range of up to 60 feet, which you are there, and each creature within 20 feet of the grenade is a target of it, and they all must make DC 15 dexterity checks.
Right.
So that's enough to include 6 of the 8 targets in front of you.
Cool. Let's do that.
Yeah. And so I'm gonna roll dexterity saves for each of them. Oh, first one gets an at 20. So.
Can you say whether they're corpse or shadow?
Huh?
Can you say whether they're corpse or shadow? Like first shadow, first corpse, that kind of thing.
Yes. I'm rolling the 3 corpses first. So, first one saves, second one fails, third one saves. Shadows roll. First shadow saves, second shadow saves, third one fails. You do 6 radiant damage to the gang. Go ahead and roll me some radiant damage.
6d6 or 5d6?
5d6.
5d6. All right, sorry, I didn't hear you. Yeah, 4...
That's okay, it's hard to hear.
13?
13 total?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on while I do some quick arithmetic.
And I guess I'll hit the one that's been hit already as well. I don't know if he's the one that saved. Maybe he's the one that got the nat 20. Who knows?
I assumed you wanted to focus fire to an extent. So the shadows are vulnerable to radiant damage, so they take double damage whether they after the success or failure. So the ones that succeed take the 13, and the ones that fail take 26.
Good.
Yeah.
And if these really are revenants, that would mean it would cancel their regeneration for a turn.
Yes, that is correct.
I hate revenants. Sure. I really like
Well, killing revenants means that they'll continue to come after you.
Yeah.
Nilzen chose these guys and specially selected each of them to relentlessly pursue you for as long as you remain in the outskirts of his territory.
Okay.
I mean, it's a sovereign glue moment.
Do they have a maximum range, or is it just like they follow you anywhere?
They seek revenge.
Right.
And if we kill them, we have about a day worth of respite.
Yeah, it takes them a day to reform and continue their pursuit after you guys.
Okay.
That's under normal circumstances.
Huh? What's that, darling?
Do you have jumper cables?
I do. They're in the trunk of my car.
Which one of these opens the trunk?
That one. Okay. Let's see here. Okay, so you gravely injure the advancing revenants. And then you injure the shadows, the shadow that was damaged by the lightning bolt, even though he saved on his saving throw against your radiant bomb, he's just completely annihilated by it.
Oh.
And then the second one, the third one who failed his save, he's just completely annihilated by it. And so there are only two shadows left. One of them is unharmed, and one of them is critically injured by radiant damage.
Okay.
So there are still four revenants remaining, and there's only two shadows.
Alrighty.
So that was a pretty good use of some gear from your shop there, Mari.
Yeah, I gotta get more.
My only yeah.
That was a potent potable right there.
It was. Potent.
Jesus.
I look at my team members and go, remember, they're only $5.95 on Sunday.
No team discounts?
Sorry, that's with the team discount. That's
Thusk, it's your action.
All right. They're still 120 feet away from me, right?
Yeah, they have not had the opportunity to advance yet.
Okay. I'll just move up 30 feet and then focus on whichever revenant looks the most injured and use Eldritch Blast.
Okay.
So that's three beams all on one. Cool. Two natural 20s and a 25 to hit.
Holy balls.
That's two natural 20s and one. Yeah.
That's pretty good. The revenants have damage resistance against necrotic, so go ahead and roll double.
Eldritch Blast is actually force damage.
Oh, I forgot that. You go ahead and just roll a whole crap ton of damage.
All right, so it's D10 per. So, let's see, the first one is okay. So I'm rolling 5d10. So 24 points of damage to whatever revenant's the most injured, and it gets pushed back 30 feet. That's 10 feet per beam.
Yeah. That's pretty dang good. The revenant one who's been electrocuted and flashbanged and Eldritch speared has taken 51 points of damage total, and he's not regenerating, along with two of his companions. It is the monster's turn. Blades sing from their scabbards, and you can immediately see wraith-like tendrils of necrotic energy trickle along the edge of the blades as they close in around Gemma and her mighty celestial lion steed. The one that got knocked back rejoins the fray. And the four of them together try to kill the lion in order to topple her from her steed. Let's see here, I'm going to need some more dice.
I'm going to disadvantage on one of those attacks.
You use your shield to impose a disadvantage on one on the first attack. Okay. So their attacks are as follows. 22, 7, these are all targeting your lion, by the way. 22, 17.
17 hits. Armor class is 12.
All four of them strike with their necrotic blades.
Oh, God.
Probably this one. So. All right, I'll avenge him and then resummon him.
Mm-hmm. So, adding four onto this. Your celestial lion takes 11 slashing and 2 necrotic, so that's 13 damage from the first attack. He takes 12 damage, slashing damage, and 3 necrotic.
He's already dead.
Yeah, okay. Allow me to re-roll the last attacks for the revenants against you as you fall from your steed.
Oh.
roll me a DC 10 dexterity check in order to avoid falling on your ass.
I get a nat 20.
Nat 20. You do a somersault.
Hi-ya!
You do a somersault and they swing out and hit empty air because you land not where they anticipated you to be. So you land clear and you avoid the two extra blades. But you are caught unaware by the invisible shadows that are right next to them. And so both of the shadows attack you, Gemma, with advantage.
Why do they have advantage? Is that because of the stealth attack?
Yes, they're not invisible. They are stealthy, and so unless you had a passive perception of 16 or higher, they would be hidden from you.
Okay.
First shadow hits. I shouldn't presume. I got 18 plus 4 is 22. And 16 plus 4 is 20.
Both miss.
Both of the shadows strike you with their strength-draining touch.
Oh, God. Those kind of shadows, yes. I've forgotten.
Yes.
They both missed. Yeah.
What's your armor class?
23.
Oh, shit.
23. Damn. This reveals them from their hiding places inside of the shadows of the Revenants. And so you're just surrounded by monsters now as they are all within 5 feet of you. Mm-hmm. That's it for the first turn. It starts back at the top of the order with Sardu.
I will call down lightning on the weakest of the Revenants again. DC 18 dex saving throw.
Okay.
And if there's anybody else within 5 feet of him, they also. So if they've locked in around Gemma, then that might hit somebody else.
Oh, definitely. If you hit the most wounded one, you'll hit both of the Revenants on either side of him. But you will also hit Gemma.
That's fine.
Yeah, we'll go with that.
Okay.
18 saving throw. For you as well.
The Revenant 1 fails. Revenant 2 fails. Revenant 3 also fails. So, Gemma, go ahead, roll down dexterity.
I tied it. I got an 18.
I think that succeeds, and you take half damage.
Yeah. And it's
so eight go ahead.
Of lightning.
Eight, was that eight?
18.
18, okay.
And then I will use a bonus action to turn into an elephant. And
stomp 40 feet forward closer to the combat. That's my turn.
All right, you guys have done 69 damage to the first Revenant, 24 to the second, and 31 to the third. The fourth Revenant has not taken damage yet.
Not been touched.
Do the Revenants regain? Okay.
They heal if they don't get tagged with radiant damage on their turn, but I'm pretty sure that they're going to. after Sardun assails them with lightning... assails them with lightning and transforms into an elephant, it becomes Gemma's turn.
Trumpeting battle turn.
I'm going to try and hit two different ones with my two attacks.
Okay. Go ahead, roll them one at a time.
And I hit neither of them. I can't hit anything tonight.
Oh. Crap.
Gemma swings her Holy Avenger threateningly.
I haven't gotten used to the sword yet. It's very big. It's weighted poorly, I think.
Do you have a bonus action at all?
No, I'm going to keep... No.
Okay. It is Mari's turn.
Alright, I'm going to run over to the group of them that's 60 foot away from me.
Yeah.
No, that's right, Mari's. Yeah.
And I will do... I'll attack the shadows. How many shadows still remain? Two?
There are two shadows. One is critically injured and one is unharmed.
Correct. All right, so I'm going to attack the one that's critically injured with my first attack.
Okay. They hide automatically on their turn, so once again, you're the only one person who can see them.
Yeah, that's what I figured. So I figured this is good for me to try to take care of. 26 to attack the first one.
Oh, easily hitting him.
I roll some damage. I get max damage, so I get 13.
Okay, so you pummel him with fists of fury, and he dissipates into a poof of black smoke.
And then I'll turn my fist to the next one. You shadows are no match for the Night Breeze clan. This is exactly what we trained for. Ha ha ha! 20.
20 hits.
And I guess I will... I'll use Flurry and get two more attacks.
Okay, how much damage did you do with that second attack?
Six damage.
Huh?
Six.
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 Even from magical fists, it is halved to three. So he takes three damage from that second follow-up attack, and then you Flurry on him.
Yeah, I do 15. Does 15 hit?
15 hits. They have armor class 12. Just
all right, so I hit with
just
both
to satisfy. Them. Yeah.
I hit with both of them. And I do 11 and 10. So 5
all
and
right.
5. 5
and 6. 5 and 5.
Cool.
You critically injure the second shadow.
Nice. Bard kind of gives a hand wave. If they have intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of snubs her nose a little bit.
Yeah. After Mari acts, it becomes Thusk's second turn.
All right. I'll move up another 30 feet. They're still quite a ways away. I can't see the shadows, right?
You're unable. You could use a use an action to perceive, but
that's yeah. It sounds like a terrible idea.
They say even after they.
All right. I'll just use my bonus action to cast Hex on the most damaged revenant. Which, I mean, it only gives me necrotic damage and they have resistance to that, but it's something. They'll also have a disadvantage on, I'll say, their wisdom saving throws.
Okay.
And then I'll attack them. Three times with the blast again. They have AC 12.
The
Revenant. The Revenants.
The Revenants have AC 17 from half plate armor.
Okay, so two hits then. I do 2d10 plus. So I do 10, so I do 5. 7, 14, 19 points of damage total.
Nice.
That's with a halved necrotic damage.
Okay. Yeah, so Revenant 1 has taken 88 points of damage.
And he gets shoved back another 20 feet.
You shove him back, and does that end your turn?
Yep, that's everything I can do.
Okay. The Revenants close in once again. I'll say two of them close in on Gemma, and two of them close in on Mari, since you guys are forming the front ranks of the fighting line right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll make the cheap little shadow get a sucker punch on Gemma first, though. He gets an 18 missing her.
Hard sucker punch to take.
So the shadow is ineffective again on this round. Little more than a distraction. and the Revenants continue their assault. Two attacks against Gemma. 7. So I got a 20 and a 23. I believe one of them hits you. I do 9 points of slashing damage and 3 necrotic.
12 total?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so then two of them come lunging after Mari, who's right next to you, Gemma. You have the option of you impose protection on Mari. And so he misses because your shield intervenes from the attack. And the last and final Revenant tries to slash Mari as well. Ouch, and gets a critical hit.
Oh.
Double damage. Double damage. 10. So 13 slashing damage. And 7 necrotic damage. As he deals a vicious critical strike against Mari. And that is it for my monsters. All of the Revenants heal 10 hit points.
You gotta do fire or radiant?
I gotta hit them before I can do any radiant damage against them.
Just let us know.
I'm really trying.
Sardun, it's back to your turn, buddy.
I charge into the healthiest Revenant.
Okay. Revenant number 4 has not been damaged yet.
I do a gore attack against him.
Mm-hmm.
Am I able to flank him or anything to get advantage with my charging attack?
I am still on the fence regarding the optional flanking rules. Since you guys are all charging in on the same line, I'm going to say in this scenario, it does not grant a flanking bonus.
Alright. I get a 24 to hit him.
Easily enough to strike the Revenant.
4? 18 points of bludgeoning damage, which is magical.
Yeah.
And he has a DC 12 strength saving throw to be knocked for him.
This is our magical.
He succeeds on his saving throw.
Okay.
That ends Sardun's turn. Can you still use your lightning bolt attack while you're in elephant form?
Yeah, but it takes an action.
Ah. Okay, so that ends your turn then?
Yeah.
Gemma, it's all you.
All right, I am really going to try to hit some guys this time. Can I move when I'm hitting somebody?
If you were to move from your spot, you'd provoke an attack of opportunity from two of your adversaries.
All right, well, I'll just try and hit two of them. Oh, whoops, ignore all those other guys. So I got a 22 and an 18.
Both of those hit.
Finally. Okay, so hold on. This does 1d8 plus 8. Okay, so the first one gets hit for 20 plus 4, 24 points. No, sorry, 27 points. The second one gets hit for 21 points. Of radiant damage.
Oh my gosh, you do radiant damage to both of them?
Nice. Yeah, by Holy Avenger.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, that's gonna
help. I forgot that it's all radiant damage, right?
The weapon.
Hold on, I'll look. Let me just look it up here to save my curiosity.
Yeah, one of those D8s might be slashing.
I rolled right past it. There it is.
Yes, I guess at first.
Holy crap! The Holy Avenger does 2d10 extra radiant damage on top of its normal weapon properties.
Yep.
Yeah, so but I guess that first d8 is probably normal damage. Is that how you would rate that, Tori?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, the normal d8 would be normal slashing damage, and then the 2d10 is radiant.
Yeah, so the first one did 11 radiant, the second one did 3 radiant.
Yeah.
But it, when they take any radiant damage, they stop healing for that turn.
But are they resistant to normal?
I don't think
so. Nope, they're not. They don't have resistance. Resistance to that. So, Revenant 1 has taken 105 hit points of damage. Revenant 2 has taken 35 damage. Yes. Yes, indeed. Gemma, is that it for your turn?
Yes.
Do you want to smite either of these mofos?
No.
Okay. Mari, it's your turn.
All right, I'm going to attack the remaining shadow. I'll hit with a 16.
Hits.
I'm sorry, roll damage first. I do 6.
6 is enough to match his max hit points, and so he disappears in a poof of black smoke. There are no shadows left.
Okay. My second attack was a 23 then, and I'll just aim it at the one of the revenants that Gemma is fighting.
Okay, yeah. You can aim it at Revenant 1 or 2 or 3 or 4.
I'll do Revenant... Revenant 2.
Okay.
So 35 damage guy. And I'll do 6 points of damage. And I'll also spend a key point to make a stunning fist. I know they have high con, but roll a DC 17 con save.
Okay, they have a +7 to this, so you have a 55% chance of stunning. Oh, I rolled a nat 20.
Okay.
So no stun for Mari this turn.
Well, the turn's not over. I'll spend a key point I'll spend it for patient defense, and I'll use my last action, my bonus action to... Oh, I guess I don't have a bonus action, do I? So I don't have a bonus action anymore, and I'll just use patient defense.
Okay.
I dodge.
Okay. It becomes the Revenant's turn. Since the Paladin extends her whole...
Isn't it my turn?
Oh, I'm sorry. I skipped Thusk. I'm sorry.
Was wondering there for a second. I'm just going to... I'm 60 feet away from them by this point, unless they've moved forward.
Yeah.
So... Yeah. Not going to bother changing the wing formula here. Well... Yeah, I'll. Is there a way I can get all four of them in tentacles?
Yes, but it would include all three of your allies as well.
Damn it. All
right. I have defense.
I'm not gonna subject the others to it. That's all right. I'll just move forward and do the Eldritch Blast thing again.
Okay. Move forward within 30 feet.
Are all four of them still up?
Yes. Revenant 1 is looking quite haggard at this point.
I did forget to say something on my turn, but as a free action, can I just be like, strike to knock out? I don't know.
Can you...
Undead cannot be knocked out or interrogated. They are destroyed when they hit HP 0.
Oh, are they? Okay.
I mean, I can cast Speak with Dead at will, so we could try it, but...
You could.
Yeah. All right. First attack hits, does plus the necrotic. So first attack does 4 points of damage total. Second attack.
You're targeting the most wounded of the revenants.
Yeah, I'm doing the attacks one at a time, just to
okay.
Alright, second attack also hits, does 8 points of damage. Third attack also hits, does 3 points of damage. So.
That's 18 total?
Yes. No, 4, 7, 8, 15 total.
Oh, 15 total. 15 total. So you guys have done 100. You guys have done 120 damage to Revenant 1, 41 damage to Revenant 2, 21 damage to Revenant 3, and 18 damage to Revenant 4. Revenants 3 and 4 both heal 10 hit points.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's only 10 around.
Yeah.
Sorry, we can deal with it.
As it becomes their turn, they now target each of you individually with a vengeful glare. So some of you are within Gemma's aura of courage and the aura of her Holy Avenger, so you get a bonus and an advantage against this DC 15 wisdom saving throw, except for Thusk, who is just at the outside of her aura and must roll regular wisdom saving throw without the bonus.
Alrighty.
What's my bonus?
Plus 3, and you have advantage.
Yeah. It's a DC 15 wisdom saving throw?
That is correct, or be paralyzed with fear.
Yeah, I'm super good. I have 28. I got both a gentleman and a naturals.
hold on just 1 second. Let me look.
What's the DC? I'm sorry.
DC 15.
Okay, I'm all right.
Oh, no, never mind. Okay. Nope, I'm paralyzed with fear.
Yeah, one of them stares vengefully at you as you continue to flail on at him at a distance, and he paralyzes you with fear as you realize that this thing will not stop at its destruction to kill you. It will continue to pursue you. And it fills you with otherworldly fear. The rest of you guys, Sardun, did you pass?
Yeah, I got 27.
You're good. So those of you within the aura are protected by Gemma's aura of courage, and Thusk is paralyzed with fear. And that is it for. Oh, I forgot that the Revenants have multi-attack. Damn it! so they end their turn, and they pass it on to you guys. It starts with Sardun's fourth turn.
Yeah, I wasn't sure if that was an ability that I gave the samurai widow revenant thing, or if it was a thing. I've been using it in one of my other games.
Samurai widow.
Revenant. Yeah. Nice. Tori and I did it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. We'll talk about it later.
Okay.
Giant elephant dwarf.
Giant dwarf elephant.
I think I'm gonna take one of them and just try to lie on top of it. Can I perform a grapple check against it?
Sure.
Which one?
I'll roll
the healthiest one.
Yeah, I'll roll strength plus 4. I got a 10 total on my roll.
I got a 25.
Oh. Yeah, you just turn around and plop down right on top of it, pitting him to the ground.
This is not an elegant fighting style.
So yeah, you just sit right on top of one of the revenants. I'm assuming Revenant 4, since he's the most uninjured one.
Yeah, the healthiest.
It just restrains him and keeps him from damaging any of your allies.
Yeah.
After that, it becomes Gemma's turn.
I'm going to use my action to cast Crusader's Mantle, so everyone within 30 feet of me, if you do a weapon attack, you get 1d4 radiant.
Ooh!
That's a pretty good move.
Ooh.
You have to hit with a weapon, though, Thusk.
That's alright, I've got one.
Okay.
I've got a packed weapon.
You're also paralyzed.
Oh. Oh, for how long?
Forever.
until that revenant deals damage to you, or until the end of the revenant's next turn. So it means you spend. It means you spend one turn frozen.
Right. All right.
So, Gemma, was that a bonus action, or was that your action doing
that? That's an action. That's my turn.
Okay. So you empower everybody's weapon attacks, and then it becomes Mari's turn.
Okay. In that case, I am going to swing out at the first one.
Okay.
Get a 17.
Matches.
Swing out at the second one. Get a 26.
Mm-hmm.
I'll use a bonus action to swing out at the third one. Natural one. can I key in flurry?
Oh, sure. Just for poops and giggle, roll a DC 10 dex saving throw.
You have advantage and plus 3.
I destroy it.
Yeah.
All right, and then a 22 to hit the third one.
I was just fishing for another nat 1, is all.
So I get all 3. I got a 22 on the last one. What's my extra damage?
D4. It's not much.
D4 on each of those attacks. That's pretty impressive.
So 9 damage, regular, 1 radiant on the first one. 7 and 4 on the second one. 6 and 3 on the third one.
Wow. So your fists just explode with radiant light as you perform your classic Ip Man style Wing Chun just obliteration move as you just tenderize the thing's solar plexus straight through the breastplate, and your final strike just completely explodes the back of the revenant, and he dissolves into powder in front of you.
I'm going to have to take a phone call real fast, but I'll be right back.
Okay.
But yeah, I imagine like a wooden dummy, and I'm just kind of going through the kata. Ding, 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 ding.
Yeah, you just dismantled him.
Yeah.
I'll be back in a second.
Yep.
After Mari ends his fourth turn, it becomes Thusk's fourth turn.
All right. I'm going to move the final 30 feet up.
Oh, wait, you're paralyzed.
Oh, that's right. I'm paralyzed.
Yeah.
Damn it.
Yeah, it becomes the Revenant's turn. Revenant 1 is no longer with the living. Revenant 2 tries to clobber Gemma. He takes 2 attacks this time.
Shit.
Right. The first one missed pitifully, but the second one got a 23, matching your armor class, Gemma.
Okay.
He does 8 points of slashing damage and 6 points of necrotic damage.
Okay, hold on a second. Let me roll on. Concentration is constitution?
Yes.
Okay, I'm good.
Mm-hmm. Let's see here. The second one attacks Mari, who's right next to you, Gemma. So if you wanted to, you pose a disadvantage on his first attack.
Two attacks that he did, can I tell which one was more... was worse.
Mm.
I would like to have done that one.
Yeah, you apply the disadvantage before you know the results of the roll.
No, but like which one of those hit me worse? I don't remember. I just added it up.
Are they both the same? Is what she's asking. Like, is one a bite attack and one a claw attack? Are they both 2 sword attacks?
They're all sword attacks. They're all identical.
Okay, then that's fine.
Mm-hmm. So the disadvantage prevents him being able to lay a hand on Mari with his first attack, and he follows up with a second attack. Gets 11 plus 7, which is an 18, not enough to stop Mari. And then the one underneath Sardoon's bum attacks twice. Got a 23 and a 20.
Yeah, both of those hit.
Both of those hit. He does 15 with the first damage. With the second damage.
Right, so I take 28 points of damage, and I do two concentrations.
Advantage.
And plus 3.
And plus 3, so plus 4. And I succeed both my concentrations to maintain my call lightning.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And after that, that is the end of the Revenant's turn. As the one dies in front of you, Mari, it swears an oath of vengeance against you. And from now on, that Revenant is now keyed to you, and in any future encounters, he'll do plus 4d6 damage against you.
Oh, yep. Shit.
It's all right.
Just, is that how they work?
Let me take all of the vengeance.
Depending on where the Revenants place their oaths will determine it. So you don't get to decide where the Revenants place it, but you could theoretically kill each one of them and then take and then convince.
That's more what I was trying to aim for.
Yeah. After that ends their turn and it becomes Sardoon's turn.
So, can I further my grapple to fully restrain him or just mash his arms so they don't work anymore?
Yeah, you could roll another grapple check against him in order to knock him prone while grappled, effectively pinning him.
Okay, that's what I want to do.
Yeah, roll strength. Plus 4 on this. I got 17.
Ooh, I got 19.
Yeah, so you put more weight onto him until his knees buckle underneath of him, and he collapses into a straddle, into a full split, as you just completely put the bulk of your elephant girth on top of him.
Roll over flat.
Just flop down directly on top of him. He immediately issues his oath of vengeance against you right now as he realizes that he's completely outdone in this scenario. you guys look and all you can see is just a single mailed fist sticking out from under the edge of Sardo, just flailing impotently.
Oh no.
Oh, it becomes, you know what? I'm stupid. Never mind, keep going.
It becomes Gemma's turn.
So there's two, correct?
There's two that you can have. You have a clear line of sight against. You have disadvantage to target the one underneath Sardoon.
No, that one's under control. I'm gonna take two attacks against one against each of them, and get a 15 and a 16. No, right? 17, right?
What's wrong? 15 is 15. It's 17 armor class. So unfortunately, both of those miss.
Yeah. That's my turn.
Becomes Mari's turn.
I'll strike out one to each to start off. 19 and 19. I forgot I had brutal punches, so 12 plus 4 for the first one.
Yeah.
And
so you do 16 with the first attack.
7 plus 2 for the next one. Should I divide it by radiant? Or does it matter? Do they take extra?
You don't have to because they don't take extra damage. It just freezes their regeneration.
Yeah, okay. All right. Then I'll take... What do they look like? Pretty bad? Pretty okay? I'll go to the first one and I'll do a flurry. I'll just do it.
Yeah. Yeah, go for it.
But both of them will miss, with one being a natural one.
Okay. Anything else?
For this turn? Can I...
Oh, you used your bonus action already.
Yeah, can I make him roll for stun?
I forgot that they are immune to stun, so your character, from the first stun attempt, you realize that they are immune to stunning
sure.
effects.
Right. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you do not need to spend another key point to discover their immunity.
Mm-hmm. All right. Then I am finito.
Yeah. He's taken 57 points of damage, the other one has taken 11 points of damage, and the last one has 0 points of damage because he regenerated for a couple rounds. So it becomes Thusk's turn.
Alright, let's see. One of them has been hit this round, right, for radiant damage?
Mm-hmm.
They both okay. have.
They both have for radiant damage.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just one has taken radiant damage this round.
Oh, right, the other one's full. Okay. I'll direct my first attack against the... You know what, let's just focus fire on one. I will, let's see, drag my packed weapon out of the air beside me, and roll to hit the damaged one. That's,
okay.
Two attacks, one hit. Let's see, it's D8 plus... D6 necrotic, and what's the radiant damage from her aura?
It's a D4.
It's D4? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, so I do... six necrotic plus another 5, so 11. So 5 necrotic total, plus 4 is 9. 12 points of damage. 3 of which are radiant.
Okay. 12 points of damage. He's taken 69 points of damage.
And that's it for my turn. Okay. And I'll move to try and flank it, if we can flank.
It becomes the Revenant's turn, and so first the one sandwiched underneath, smushed underneath Sardun is going to attack with disadvantage. But he's issued his Oath of Vengeance, so he's boosting damage against you, Sardun.
Can he attack? Is he fully restrained?
He's a prone and grappled, so he's got a disadvantage to hit you.
No.
Mm-hmm. He misses, getting a 12 total.
That actually hits.
and he gets a 15, so he strikes you twice. He hits you for 27 points of damage on the first swing. And he hits you for 27 points of damage on the second swing. So he hits you for 54 points of damage total this turn.
Okay.
As he turns into just a vengeful blender. You are sitting on a vengeful lawnmower blade.
Yeah, and that's enough to clear my elephant form.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That is it for the one. Now, one attacking Gemma. Gemma, you've incurred enough wrath from this thing for it to issue its oath of vengeance against you, and so he promises to fell you in the name of his dark master Nilzen, and he strikes at you twice.
Dude, don't try to vengeance the vengeance paladin. I'm not able.
He misses you twice. He gets a 9 and a 21. And the third one tries to hit Mari. Yeah. You apply disadvantage to his first attack. He misses. He gets a 14 total. And he rolls with normal for a second attack against Mari. And he misses again. So Revenants are unable to hit you. Revenant number Revenant number 3 heals to 1 point of damage, so Revenant 2 has taken 69 damage, Revenant 3 has taken 1 damage, and Revenant 4 is unharmed.
Why did Revenant 3 heal damage?
He was unharmed this turn.
No, my first attack hit the first, and the second one hit the second guy.
Oh, okay. I spread out the damage incorrectly then. So
my bad. I heard you say that earlier, and I was like, I wonder if he, yeah.
minus 12 from Revenant 2, and plus 12, and, well, let's see here, plus 22 to Revenant 3. So, Revenant 2 is at 57 damage, Revenant 3 is at 23 damage, Revenant 4 is at 0.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. That ends their turn. Sardoon, it's back to you, my druid companion.
Let's see.
I think I'm going to take... a disengage action. No. I'll just back off. If I just back off, how many attacks opportunity are you like about? Just one?
Just one from this guy. He has disadvantage against you because he's prone still.
Okay. I'll provoke that attack of opportunity.
And he will take it. He got a 17 to hit you.
Yeah, that hits.
Connects for... 21 points of damage.
It's my con. 21, you said?
Yeah.
Okay, and that breaks my concentration.
It is still your turn.
What I was planning on doing. So it's going to...
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that. John, you're rustling a whole lot.
Sorry.
What was that, Jesse?
He's rethinking his life.
Yeah. And then probably to be nearish to Thusk.
Okay.
Maybe about 10 feet away from Thusk. And then cast heat metal on the one that is at full health.
Oh, nice.
Okay. Yeah. There's no saving throw involved. You just do 2d8 points of damage to him and negate his healing, his regeneration.
So that does 7 points of fire damage. And I'm done.
Okay. So, yeah, so you tag him with damage, and then you pass the turn to Gemma.
All right. I'm going to try and hit the two that didn't just get hit with fire damage.
Okay.
I get a 20 and a miss.
Okay, that connects.
So that'll do... Come on, you. My mouse is freaking out. 17, 21 points of damage, and that's partially radiant.
Yeah, so you've done 78 points of damage to Revenant number 2.
Sorry, let me add my... I forgot my d4. Plus 4, so...
Yeah. 82 points of damage.
And there.
You pass the turn to Mari.
Alright, I'm just going to unload on Revenant number 3 with 4 attacks from a flurry.
Nice.
Oh, damn.
And I will... My lowest roll is a 13, which probably doesn't hit.
Yeah, the 13 doesn't hit. Their armor class is 17 for their half-plate armor.
Uh-huh. I don't think that I hit with a second attack then. Alright, so I hit twice. I get... 17 damage and 10 damage.
17. You do 27 points damage, adding to 23. Revenant 3 has taken 50 damage.
Mm-hmm.
And it becomes Thusk's turn.
Hey, and I can actually do something.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see. I'm right next to...
Sardoon.
Right, okay. I'm right next to Sardoon. So I'm going to try and... can I run a blank one? Is that possible?
Right now your allies' backs are faced to you and your enemies' fronts are faced to you. So you cannot flank from your current angle, but you do have at least removed enough of the confusion of the battlefield to be able to place a Vard's Black Tentacle on the three remaining revenants without hitting your allies. You have a clear shot. Now that Sardoon isn't mixed up in it, you can include all three of them at the edge of your
Black at the tentacles. Edge of the Okay, excellent. Mm-hmm. Well, let's just go ahead and do that then. Why not? Let's see. Mm-hmm. I will cast that. And they need to make a saving throw. Dexterity.
Mm-hmm. Three dexterity saving throws.
DC 17.
Two fails and one success.
Okay. And the fails take, let's see, 3d6, I believe. Yeah, 3d6. Yep. They take 11 bludgeoning damage, and they are restrained.
Okay. 11. 11. 11. And restrained is pretty good this year. 93 damage.
Oh, the one that saved. The one that saved doesn't take any damage.
Ah, okay. He's just and not restrained as well.
And he's not restrained, right?
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's my turn.
Okay, so that ends Thusk's turn. The first one who is not restrained immediately provokes an attack of opportunity from Mari and Gemma as he tries to vacate so Revenant number 4 provokes two attacks of opportunities because he does not want to stay there.
I hit him for 13 damage.
And I miss.
Okay. Let's see here. He's taken 20 damage total as he vacates the square, and he rushes straight up to Sardoon since he's still got the Oath of Vengeance. He's keyed to Sardoon, so he's runs right up next to him and he swings twice.
Disadvantage on all of his attacks in this battle.
Oh, that's right. He gets a 19 to hit you with the first attack. And he gets a 16 to hit you with the second attack.
Also, just really hits.
Both of those connect. Does 21 points of damage to you with the first attack.
Okay.
And the second attack grapples you and does 11 points of damage.
Very good.
Okay.
Yeah, and he's got a hold of you right now.
Okay.
So that was Revenant 4. Revenant 3 is still sparring with Mari. First I'll resolve the attack against the two attacks against Gemma, and then I'll move to Mari.
Sure.
So two attacks from Gemma from Revenant 2. One miss and one critical hit.
Okay.
Oh.
Let's He does 25 points of damage to you, Gemma, with a vicious critical hit.
Okay. I'm going to use my reaction to cast Hellish Rebuke. He
okay.
has a saving throw.
Okay. He gets a 13 on his saving throw.
So he fails and takes 12 points of fire damage.
Give him a face full of fire. He's at 106 damage total. And then Revenant 3 now tries his assault against Mari.
And I'll still impose disadvantage on one of those. Oh, no, wait, I can't. Your reaction. Never mind.
Yeah, you used your reaction, so he takes two attacks against Mari. Gets a 17 and a 25.
That's a hit.
Does 14 points of damage to you.
All
right. Let's see here. That ends all of the Revenant's turn. That was turn 6 for them. Turn 7, Sardun.
I will. So, first of all, he takes another 2d8 fire damage from heat metal.
Uh huh.
So, another 5 damage.
Revenant 4 has taken 25 damage. None of them are regenerating for the past turn.
Good.
Thusk is still right next to me, right?
Yeah, Thusk is 10 feet away from you.
10 feet away? Okay.
Come in.
I wanted to. Thusk acts right after me, right?
No, I act after Mari.
But you act before the Revenant?
Right.
Okay. In that case, I'm going to run 30 away from back of opportunity.
Okay. He has you grappled, so you're unable to. You are immobile.
Oh, okay. In that case, I will. I'll just. Turn back into an elephant on top of him.
Second elephant.
Yeah, that's my sense of that. So I've got a bit of extra HP. And that's both my
action. Okay. So, Sardun ends seventh turn. Gemma, it's your seventh turn.
How do the two next to Mari and I look again?
Revenant 2 has taken 106 damage. Revenant 3 has taken 61.
Okay, so I'll keep hitting. The Revenant 2 is the one next to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll keep hitting him. First hit is a 21.
Yes.
The 32 points of damage.
Wow. 32 points of damage is enough to smite the Revenant and send him and explode him. And he swears an oath of vengeance against you, Gemma, swearing that he will be back and that he will do double damage against you next time.
Oh.
He had already sworn that. I'm not that worried.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
He said just does a lot of swearing. He's not really backing this up. I'm gonna try
he swears more vengeance against you.
So the one next to Mari, I do a 22, so I hit. And I do 27 points of damage to him. With radiant.
Okay, that's pretty good. You've done 88 points of damage to Radiant through Revenant 3. And none of them are getting their regeneration this turn. Mari, it is your turn.
Alright, same as I did last time. I'll hit three times for 10, 12, 13 damage.
13 total?
No, 10, 12, and 13.
Oh, wow. So,
she goes, pop, pop, pop.
Six. No, 35. You do 35 points of damage to Revenant 3.
And she kind of spits in its face a little bit. Tell your master when you get back to him in ashes that we're coming for him. You hear me?
Yeah.
We're coming for him!
Yeah. Revenant 3 still wrapped up in the inky black tentacle, Evard's black tentacles is...
Does oh, would I have an advantage?
No, he just has disadvantage against attacks against
right,
you. Right, I've been taking care of that.
Alright, I wasn't sure if I did. Because one of them, the one that missed, I would have rolled again. That's fine.
Actually, now I'm doubting myself. I have to look up restraint now.
He might not. It might just be that he can't.
You are correct, John. Attack rolls against this creature have an advantage, and creatures in attacks that he makes have a disadvantage. Wow, Vartzbach tentacles really freaking good.
Isn't it? Well, they get a save every round. Too,
yeah.
So.
I apologize, Gemma. I robbed you of a turn of free advantage against your first foe. But you smoked the shit out of him anyway.
I still missed the last attack.
Okay. And after that, it becomes Thusk's turn.
Alrighty. Let's see. Maintaining concentration on the Avards, and I will attack.
Oh, does it do damage? Does it do damage automatically?
It actually it should have damage on their turn.
Yeah.
Their turn.
They start their turn in it or move through it on their turn.
Their turn in it and they're restrained, they take 3d6. So
okay. Don't worry. I'm keeping track of it now.
Okay.
Let's see here. Revenant 3 has taken 123 damage. Revenant 4 has taken 25. Neither of them are regenerating. Okay.
And I will take an attack against the nearly dead one then.
Go for 4. Go for 3.
Yeah, I'm going for 3. We'll spread out the vengeance. I'm gonna be left out if I don't get some vengeance.
I know. I'm just trying to keep you alive, John.
No.
Story would avenge you anyways.
I'm bad at staying alive. Let's see. First attack. I get advantage on it. Ah.
Mm-hmm. You get advantage on all of your attacks.
Good, because I actually hit. Okay. I do 2, 4, 8, plus 2 necrotic, so 10 damage total.
10 damage is enough to take him...
Oh, okay.
That's the first... Okay, yeah, so you do... He's taken 133 damage.
Okay. And second attack... also hits, and I do 8, 9, 10, 14, 16 points of damage to him with second attack.
You obliterate him as he swears an oath of vengeance against you, Thusk. So it's actually good that all of you guys got one oath of vengeance, because it could have been bad in the next encounter if one of you had two coming after you doing swinging for double damage.
It'd have been fine.
Could have been hairy.
Amari has 60 feet of movement. She could just run around in circles.
That's true.
60 feet of movement. Dodge every turn.
Yeah.
I'll just have to give them flying mounts next time.
That's fine. We're ready. We're cloud. We can fly. We have flying mounts. We have a fly-in.
We can cast fly. We have flying mounts.
We have a flying elephant. That's crazy.
I've never seen an elephant turn into gaseous form. It's an amazing sight.
I have seen an elephant fly. It's crazy.
The last revenant is grappling with one hand, has a hold of Sardun, and he has a vengeful blade pointed right at him. And so he stabs for Sardun's heart doubly. Oh, wait, no, he's grabbing onto a tuft of elephant flesh. I have to carve through your whole beast form again. God damn it. The Revenant just breathes a sigh of just a disappointment as he goes, and he stabs twice.
Both of them.
He gets a 9 and a 23 to hit you. So he only hits you once. 16. He hits you for 17 points of damage.
Okay.
Yeah, and so that's it for the Revenant's turn. And he, yeah, he's not, the Avard's Black Tentacle now no longer has any targets. And it becomes your turn again. And you immediately fry him for more fire damage.
Yeah, so he takes another 2d8 fire.
10. Okay, so now that we only have one left, should we try to, like...
restrain him?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's a good idea.
We'll get anything out of him?
Well, he won't encounter our weapon.
Yeah, just cover him, glue him to a tree, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, we can do that.
Figure out a way to permanently immobilize him.
Yeah. This easier said than done, but it is worth a try.
We can start by grappling him and then disarming him. So I will start by trying to grapple him by putting an elephant foot on him, pushing him down toward the ground.
Okay. Yeah, you're currently grappled with him, so both of you are mobilized, so you can just try to pin him again.
Okay. I got a 10 on my grapple check.
Okay, I'll roll. I got a 12 on my strength check. So he sees the elephant butt coming at him a second time, and he sidesteps it.
Sit on me once, shame on you.
Yeah.
But me once, shame on you.
It becomes Gemma's turn. You're about 20 feet away from the Revenant.
And how bad does he look at this point?
He's taken 35 points of damage. He has precisely 101 hit points left.
I don't really have a lot of...
disarm him.
Oh, yeah. Let me go up, and how does a disarm work?
That's a good question. Have you guys ever done a disarm?
They don't breathe, do they?
Disarm.
I mean, can I try to disarm him literally?
Yeah.
That seems like the best way to do it. Just
a cold check. Yeah. I'd say a disarm would be an opposed check. It would be your dexterity against his strength.
Okay. I don't have a lot of dexterity. What if I use my strength to literally disarm him, to cut his arm off?
To dismember him?
Yeah. I'm going against S and towards brute strength.
Yeah, I'll say that you're imposing disadvantage on attack roll. And if you connect with it, in addition to the damage you deal, he'll roll a constitution saving throw.
Sure. Okay, so... I roll nat 1. Mm. I'm really trying not to hit the elephant.
You whiff pitifully. Go ahead, roll me a dex saving throw, DC 10.
A nat 20.
Yeah, you recover yourself despite your long miss. So Gemma is unable to disarm the Revenant, and it becomes Mari's turn.
Can I use sleight of hand to tie a knot?
To lasso him?
I'm going to run up to him, grab rope out of my pack, go around his neck and tie a knot.
Yeah. So you try to lasso him right and tie and draw it around his neck. This would be an attack roll.
Okay.
Yeah, you're making an attack roll with the, you don't add your,
I wouldn't add my dexterity?
Yeah, it would be a dexterity roll. Yeah, it doesn't add your proficiency bonus to it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait, you've got sleight of hand, right?
Yeah, I do have sleight of hand.
I will say that it's a sleight of hand check. Go ahead. Sleight of hand check against his armor class.
I get a 19.
19? I'll roll strength saving throw. I rolled a 21, so I'll say that roll either dex or strength to oppose his strength roll.
Okay. I get a... Is it a saving throw or just dex?
Just a dex roll.
Then I got a 23.
23. So you lasso it around his neck, it pulls tight, and even though he struggles to yank himself free, you just hunker down with the rope and pull him tight.
So I use the rest of my turn, my movement. I'm going to use my vertical movement. I'm just going to run up a tree, over a branch, and jump off.
Oh.
And string him up.
I love it. This sounds like a stunt to me. Roll me an acrobatics check. I'd say this is a DC 12 acrobatics check.
26.
26. So you rush up the tree, fling yourself over the over a weight-bearing branch, and dangle to discover yourself not heavy enough to bear him aloft. But you are now swinging from the rope up on the tree with the rope pulled taut, dragging the guy along the ground. And so you need a little bit extra weight in order to elevate, in order to get the lift that you need as he goes up into the tree, to cause him to get up into the tree. You completely succeeded your role. You just lack the mass in order to
Mari's a little guy. Him. Person.
Yeah.
Mari's a mouse. They don't weigh a lot.
Mari and somebody else at sea, that's finesse.
Yeah. Thusk, it's your turn.
Alrighty. Let's see. We're trying to restrain him?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I will cast Hold Monster on him. That works on undead, right?
He's immune to paralysis. I'll say that your knowledge of necromancy being level 12 and all would allow you to know this in advance.
Oh, okay.
Any amount of trying to paralyze a revenant will automatically fail.
Fair enough, then. I'll
just grab me.
Yeah, I'll just aid in the grab.
Yeah, you go running up to Mari, who's dangling from a tree branch up above you, and it's a small jump. We'll say it's a DC 10 athletics check for you to leap up, grab a hold of Mari's ankles, and then the combined weight of the two of you would yank him up in bodily into the tree.
Alrighty, DC 10.
DC good. 10 athletics.
Good. I just made it.
You leap up into the air, grab a hold of Mari's ankles, and the two of you descend down as the rope flings up the tree, and the revenant comes twisting up into the air, spinning as he does so, breaks his grab a hold of the elephant, and he's dangling up in the air now as it becomes his turn. Yeah.
How high up is he?
You only said the trees are at least 60 foot total.
Have you got the trees? Yeah.
You say he's like.
Yeah,
go ahead, Tori.
I'd say that he's within arm's reach of you. His legs are within arm's reach of you guys, but because his arms are a further distance up there, he cannot reach you guys on the ground. Where sure. Like Thusk and Mari, for example, like he can swing. If he wants to try and hit you guys, but you're too low for him to be able to reach since his neck is yanked up to the tree branch. And so he does the best that he can. He tries to wriggle free of your immobilization move, Mari. Go ahead, roll sleight of hand to try and move the rope out of the reach of his sword as he tries to roll dexterity and dislodge himself from the tree branch. And cut the one hit point rope.
Sure. 20.
Oh. He got a 14. So he swings at the rope, but you see it coming and you yank the rope, you twiddle the rope out of the reach of the arc of his swing.
Cool.
Yeah. And that's it for his turn. It goes back to Sardoom's turn.
Okay. I release my concentration on heat metal and I release my wild shape, and then I recast heat metal on his sword.
Okay.
He has a con save DC 18, or he drops it.
Okay. He is not immune to this, so he fails, and the sword falls from his hand, and he's left just grabbing desperately at the rope around his neck.
There we go.
Sure.
Cool.
Much better.
Now we just have to make this permanent.
Yeah, Gemma's going to walk up and start cutting off his legs.
I feel we can just restrain him, like get some rope and tie his arms to his sides.
Mm-hmm.
If, if he bleeds out, he's still dead, right? He doesn't have blood, but I mean, like, if we cut off his legs and do too much damage, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
well,
if you
still got that regeneration, so he'll just grow
over
his stumps.
Let him heal, cut his leg off, let him, he's not going to grow a new leg, it'll just heal over, it'll scab over.
Sure, we can take our time and dismember him. That sounds like a fun day.
You had other plans, eh?
How much damage did your heat metal do, Sargon?
6
points of damage. He's taken 41 points of damage. It freezes his regeneration. And he knows he's fucked at this point. He's like, a helpless Nilzen will not let you meddle with his plans. Yeah, he's struggling to speak as you have him literally in a hangman's noose up in a tree.
Cool.
This started dark, and it took an even darker turn really fast.
Sorry, don't fuck around.
I'm just imagining you guys standing in a dark tree line on a full moon night with a corpse dangling in a tree, frothing at the mouth at you angrily.
I just don't understand why you guys don't want to dismember him. Like, I'll do the dirty work. Joke about trying to get your hands.
I'm honestly fine with dismembering him. I don't see a problem there.
Sure, take your time. Take 20.
since you guys have such a pronounced advantage, I'll declare the end to the combat and consider all combatants defeated and start a social challenge right now. As you guys are now standing in a circle, deciding what to do with your barely sequestered revenant. You've never had an undead prisoner before.
I feel like. You know, we could do the message thing real fast. Mari gives the nod for the metagame.
Sure, yeah. Let's metagame.
So, do we want to...
psychic metagame.
Do we want to dispel the eye, and do we want to cut off his arms? I feel like without arms, he can't, like, go for his neck. And if he's only barely sequestered, then we need to get his arms soon.
Yeah.
Well, As he realizes how screwed he is, he starts inflicting damage with his slam attack against himself. So sure. you guys only have a few seconds as it takes him for him to go through his mountain of hit points, tearing through his own undead flesh to try and execute himself.
I mean, is he doing radiant damage to himself?
Is he doing more than 10 points around to himself?
Yeah, he does... He does approximately 22 points of damage to himself around, and he regenerates 10 of it. So, you guys have about a minute before he successfully offs himself.
Right. Yeah. Let's chop his arms off.
Yep.
So Gemma just grab, as he's trying desperately to kill himself, Gemma, you just grab a hold of his arms and just lop off his hands at the wrist. So he just tries to stump himself ineffectively. So he's just dangling there. You can see the fight's gone out of him now at this point. He's just kind of standing there looking sad. It's for vengeance against all of you.
That's for all of it.
It's for vengeance against all of you.
Someone use the other rope. Use another rope and tie him up. I mean, I guess he can't hurt himself anymore, but...
We'll just tie him up anyway. Might as well.
Mario goes and ties the other end off on a rope around another tree. She pulls him up at least, 10 foot to avoid, any black bears or grizzlies coming to get him.
I don't think they're going to eat an undead.
You never know. You never know how bears are.
I guess not.
I'm just hanging a bear bag, that's all.
Now the question is, what do we do with him?
You leave him for up to a year so that he dissipates and never comes back. But Mari doesn't know this. Mari just knows not to kill him.
we'll say that you guys have a successful knowledge religions check. You discover this is some perverse version of a revenant. Revenants are usually emissaries sent by the gods to avenge some wrongdoing. This is clearly some type of inversion of the process here.
You know that their
job is to hunt their quarry into death and beyond.
Mm-hmm. So if he's making these, we might have a big problem if he unleashes an army of revenants against the city.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, your knowledge of religion would reveal he probably can't do these things very often. You think that these four guys are probably unique to his a unique contingent in his army. But you're almost certain that he has other tricks up his sleeve, other things that he's waiting to show to you.
Sure.
All kinds of nasty stuff.
Wow.
Hmm.
We could awaken this tree.
Oh.
What?
And just have it, like, hold him inside of it?
Yeah, just have, like, it be the Revenant Keeper tree.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, except Nilzen is watching us right now.
Just dispel it.
I need to remind you. All right, yeah. I go ahead and dispel that eye that is watching us so we can work in secret.
Sure, yeah, so you buy yourself some time by getting rid of Nilzen's spy.
Yeah. All right. So, yeah, we can trap this thing in a tree, right?
Yeah, and I assume this is a reasonable-sized tree?
Yeah, it's a great big tree. It's about the tallest weight-bearing branch is about 40 feet up in the air, so it's a mighty old tree.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I can, my, staff of the woodlands can cast Awaken. I sit down, it's an 8-hour cast, so I'd have to spend it.
Yeah. Yeah, you guys continue with your long rest, and as Sardun awakens the tree, and, you can see an old cavity inside of the tree opens up like a doorway, and tendrils extend out of it and extend around the revenant and envelop him and pull it in. And so you only his face and his two little stubs are sticking out of the edges of the bark as the tree does its best to sequester the wicked revenant.
Poor tree.
Thank you.
The tree promises to hold this guy prisoner until somebody yanks him out of it bodily, and so it's unlikely that Nilzen will send agents out this far in order to retrieve this guy. If you could set up some type of alarm system that will alert you to activity here, you could perceivably keep him sequestered here for forever.
I recommend that the great oak keeper tree wander this forest.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Oh, yes.
Keeping a mobile guard on this prisoner.
That's pretty great.
Yeah. The tree says that since we're not being observed by Nilzen, I can just uproot and relocate myself, so he'll have to come searching in order to find his toady.
Yes. You can just do that periodically. Uproot once a week and move.
Yeah, so the tree looks down. He's got, like, the revenant's face sticking out of, like, where his navel would be, and so he just uproots and just trots off while you guys are finishing breakfast.
Excellent.
Good company too in your new sentient life is
you can't do some psychological damage to the tree.
A little like quato sticking out of you.
That's kind of what they do. Trees reclaim, you know? Just part of the natural process of treeing.
Yeah. The tree is down with this program. He's content to do this.
Nitrate.
It's like my the, the, The tree's like, my life, my self-awareness and life has more meaning than most humans now, so I'm going to just go take care of this.
Wander off. Nice, guys. See you around. Oh. All right.
And this is the one that swore vengeance on Sardu.
Correct.
So there's a vengeful revenant locked inside of a tree that is hatefully thinking about your destruction, Sardu, somewhere. but when the trio of other revenants reform and come after you guys, he will not be amongst them.
Mm-hmm. He has a better life now. He'll come to learn the way of the forest.
We're friends of that tree.
He's encased in wood, just like thinking about his actions, and he's like, maybe vengeance is overrated. I don't know.
You have an overdeveloped sense of vengeance, don't you?
Well, I'm going to get you into trouble someday.
So you have less than 1 hour right now, John?
Yes.
Oh.
Do you need time before your appointment, or do you want to continue playing?
I already factored that in.
Okay, so that's all factored in?
I have something at 4 o'clock.
Awesome. Okay, so let's do a 5-minute break, bathroom breaks, get some snacks. We'll reconvene in 5 minutes, okay?
All right. Awesome.
Sounds great.
I like having so many sets of dice that I was able to just go, all right, I'm going to get 4 matching D sets of 20, 8, and 4, and just boom.
Yeah, I was about to say, it sounds like you have all of your dice rolling around on the table along with your phone there.
Yeah, I was trying to make it easier to roll 4 attacks and 48s and 44s. And count all of them.
Okay, I'm removing my headphones now, so I'll see you guys in about 5 minutes or so.
Alright, awesome.
Okay. Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you.
right, I'm back.
Yeah, we're here too.
Okay.
I'm back at my battle station as well. I've got something that I'd like to show you guys. Do some show and tell before we jump back straight into the game. I'm going to turn my camera back on.
Okay.
I baked this.
Nice.
Baked it.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, it's a
sourdough?
It's a loaf of sourdough bread.
Oh, let me turn my camera off. There we go.
Nice.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
That's awesome.
Yeah, pretty great. Yeah. I made it with wild yeast that I cultivated on my counter, and this is probably my 8th loaf, and it's easily my best looking one. We'll find out if it's the best tasting one soon too.
That looks delicious.
Since you've been doing sourdough recently, is that the first you've done any bread baking?
Yeah, this is the most basic recipe. I've been working with the most basic recipe in order to try and master it before I move on to more advanced stuff like hamburger buns and other things like that. But gone are the days of ever purchasing bread from a store because it tastes even better than it looks.
You can't go back. You've screwed yourself. You are no longer able to buy bread.
Yeah, I realized it was a one-way street. As soon as it tasted the first one, I was like, oh my god, I've been eating crap my entire life. This is the best.
Yeah, you're so screwed.
I fought back the urge to immediately hack into it when it came warm out of the oven because I wanted to show it off to you guys.
Do you have a baking stone that you baked that on?
Mm. Dutch oven.
Oh, cool. Dutch oven. Okay. Oh, I think that's
doing. Yeah. Yeah, I experimented with several different styles and could not manage the correct humidity inside of the oven. And so my girlfriend got me a Dutch oven in order to solve that problem. And it traps in the humidity to give it a nice healthy rise early on. And then a nice crunchy crust afterwards.
Do you end up lifting the lid off of the Dutch oven partway through to release the humidity, or does it stay closed the whole time?
That's correct. You bake it for like 20 minutes inside of the Dutch oven, and then you open it up to let the crust form.
Gotcha. Okay.
Taking notes.
I mean, I also just do like bread pans and make loaves, and it's not quite as nice. Like, you don't get the sweet crust, the awesome crust and stuff, but like, for convenience sake, it's nice to package them away in bags and put them in the refrigerator and they keep forever freezing.
It's pretty convenient, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
In bread without having to bake everything. I'm going to turn my video back off. That's awesome, dude.
Yeah, thank you. I like getting to show it off to you guys. So switch off the video, too, because my computer seems to be struggling with the video. I think it's just time for a new computer for me at some point.
I have to
do that. This laptop is from 2006.
I forwarded you a list my dad sent me. It was a laptop under $200. I'm looking to buy something too.
Yeah, $200 to $300 will get you. Basically.
Yeah.
If you aren't trying to do high powered PC gaming, which I've sort of given up on, $200 to $300 will put you into shape.
I play around on my PS3 when I feel the need to.
Exactly.
Right, you're not looking for a gaming computer, just something functional.
I'm definitely still doing the game computer. Can't make it alone.
Mm-hmm.
Much money, though. More money than I should be spending, really. But
Okay. Have we all reconvened, or do we need a few extra minutes of break time?
Alright.
I'm good.
Okay.
Just one question. If we have our air conditioning on, like it's on now, does that interfere with you guys hearing us? Do you hear a buzz or anything?
It does make you sound a little more staticky, but yeah, I can still hear you alright, so.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So Sardoon works through the night to awaken the mighty old oak to assist you in your travails. And you awake refreshed the next morning, with the dark clouds of smoke still rising off in the distance.
Do we need to reconvene with our were-animal friends?
Mm-hmm. We're looking for the wolves. We never found them.
See if the necromancer is still watching.
Oh, is the necromancer still watching?
You scan the area for his disembodied eyeball that he sends out to his Eye of Kilrog, and you find no sign of the Eye of Kilrog. It seems that he's taken a hint, and he's applied his attentions toward other things.
Okay. We're good for now. Of course, I don't know how much of our plan he heard back when we were planning things.
Is there a way we can give ourselves some advantage looking at these werewolves, guys? What do you guys think? Any way we can up our...
Well, we should ask the...
Drag a dead deer around?
Yeah, drag a dead deer. Perhaps maybe split up while we're looking? So we all maybe get individual roles?
As long as we can find each other again. I'm not much good at this wood stuff. Yeah, I don't trust trees.
Maybe just split up in groups of two, then.
Or we could do, like, speak with animals, speak with plants.
You have
speak with animals, sure.
Yeah, do that.
Yeah, you cast Speak with Animals, and it grants you an advantage on your survival roll regarding tracking the werewolves. The animals could give you incorrect information, so regardless of if you succeed or fail, the amount of time is going to remain the same. It's about 8 hours of tracking.
I mean, is this worth it if Nilzen knows we're coming? I guess it actually is. If he knows we're coming, then we have to show up with superior numbers. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
I can do this myself.
I got a 28 on my survival roll this time.
Oh, your survival roll is sufficient to not only track the werewolves, but you also get the jump on them, meaning you guys see them before they see you. They're like maybe 800 feet away. You can see them down in a clearing surrounding a small creek. There's like a small natural waterfall in the area. Not like a waterfall, but like it cascades down the rocks some ways. And you can see two of them are out wading in the creek fishing. And some of them are basket weaving, and some of them are cooking up by a small campfire. And they seem quite peaceful.
Really? What do you guys think? I wasn't expecting them to be peaceful basket-weaving werewolves.
I say we surprise them right in the middle, attack their leader right without telling anybody what we're doing. No, I say we try to, I guess...
We knock the back of their hands.
You know, maybe what would a druid do if they were approaching, Jesse? You know, you're... trying to be an emissary, what would you think they're the...
Yes.
That's weird. Did everyone just leave?
No.
Yeah, they did. I mean, all the lame people left.
I thought perhaps I was leaving, being forced out, and I was like, oh, Cool.
Do we need to re-invite them or something?
You know, I haven't had to be re-invited. Yeah, I'd say it's just usually you join an ongoing call.
Hello?
Welcome back.
Can you hear me? I killed my camera there. Oh, God. Weird.
Corey also got kicked out at the same time, so.
Yeah. Well, we weren't kicked out, we just couldn't hear anybody anymore. Yeah, so they both relogged. He should be back pretty quick.
Oh, I see, you did say all that. Bye.
Yep.
Well, let's devise a plan while he's not listening.
Right.
I don't really care.
I think we could totally do this the diplomatic way. You know, I think that Gemma and Thusk.
You have some sort of smell non-threatening spell to cast?
I do pass without trace.
I feel like Marty should engage in a contest for basket weaving using this.
Do you think I'm a basket weaver? I've never basket wove in my life.
You cannot become the alpha of a werewolf pack by basket weaving. It's not how it works.
Maybe. We're just here to negotiate, so we're not going to get advantage, but we can still do the persuasion that we've been doing.
Yeah. Persuade them not to kill us.
We don't understand their culture. We don't know what they're coming at us with. So I think that the most respectful route, if we're going to try to win their allegiance, is not by jumping into their camp and saying, we'll fight the strongest among them, unless that's what they want. You know?
Yeah, I think we should stroll in openly and request respectfully to meet with their elder.
Yep. Sounds like a good idea to me. Oh, there he is.
Okay. I'm uncertain of how long I kept talking for before I realized none of you guys were there.
We heard basket weaving. That was about it.
Yeah, right at about basket weaving. You guys note their peaceful demeanor despite their warlike appearance, as they have not noticed you. You guys are like up at like a woody hillock up above them, and you can see down there.
Do we have anything we could use?
We're going to kidnap all of their cubs and then use them as hostages.
There are no signs of any non-combatants about them. There's evenly split men and women, but all of them look like they can handle themselves.
I think probably the best route, if they seem peaceful, is to enter their camp openly and respectfully.
Weapons away, hands up.
Yeah.
Do we have anything we could use as a gift?
Oh, that's a good point.
Let's get a deer.
By the way, while we were resting, I resummoned my lion.
Okay.
You what? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Is anybody wearing that shirt of elven chainmail we got?
I'm not.
Yeah, your lion returns with no memory of its recent death. Where was I just now?
I waggle its little ears.
God.
You're a good lion. Good job.
Your lion now has night terrors and doesn't know why.
It's okay, I'll give him lots of fish. Food will fill his empty soul.
So you guys make an appearance to the werewolves then.
Mm-hmm.
But I like the idea of bringing an offering. Do you want that offering to be that shirt of elven chain, or should we go try to find a deer?
Why not both? I'm not sure what they'll like, whether they even like wearing armor or not.
Sardun, your high wisdom would probably note that they can handle themselves regarding getting their own deer and such. What they lack for are weapons and magical items, fetish tools that have spirits bound to them, or something that they would value.
Gemma, did you take the greatsword +1 from Zarkov? Was that what you used to be using? Or the Holy Avenger? What were you? Because we could trade that up, maybe.
Yeah, I had a plus one longsword. I don't know if that's the same one.
I've written down a plus one greatsword and a book of greats in Zarkov's journal, so we might not have liquidated that, and I might have been just holding on to it for the last little bit. I thought you would have taken it.
I don't have it in my inventory.
Yeah,
okay. Plus one greatsword.
A plus one greatsword would be an ideal gift to come bearing to these guys.
Yeah, that sounds awesome.
Yeah.
All right, let's do that then. You know, haul that out.
Well,
yeah.
Keep it tucked away for the time being and while we're entering.
Right.
But yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, respectfully and peacefully.
Yeah, as you step out into the clearing, all of the werewolves that are gathered in the glade immediately scramble to attention, pulling themselves out of the creek and getting into a vaguely defensive formation as they look on as you approach and try to discern whether you are friends or foe.
We've come with a proposition. If you'll hear us out, we'd like to speak to your pack's elder.
Leader.
What business do the dogs of Agartha have to do with the wolf?
Hey, let's not say anything that we're going to regret. All in the baby names.
All those who cower in the walls of Agartha are dogs to us.
It's actually about dogs which we come to speak. Well, hyenas. Kind of dogs, sort of.
The leader, an old werewolf with an eye patch, he spits at the mention of the noise.
We feel much the same. If you're willing to hear it out, we have come with a gift for you.
He motions for the rest of his companions to stay behind the creek, and he wades out across the creek towards you guys. And comes out to inspect the gift.
I'll leave it to Gemma and that's it with Mike.
Present him with the gift.
Yeah, he looks down and he inspects the greatsword. Says, "This is the weapon of the Inquisitors of Agartha. It has drawn the blood of many of our kin. This is how came by you this weapon, this fearsome weapon."
We killed the man who held it. How would you come by any weapon worth carrying?
I did not know how you came across it. You could have bought it, for all I knew.
Oh, no. This was a man named Zarkoth. He didn't deserve to live anymore.
Well,
I even though I don't know the name Zarkov, I know the mark of the Inquisition. It is a fearsome weapon indeed.
We will present it to you as a measure of our respect for your tribe, clan.
He grasps the great sword and inspects it. He gives it an exploratory swing to see if it's magical.
It is magical.
Yeah, he nods approvingly and he sets it aside and he sits down on the grass along with you guys and he says, Your gift pleases me, but I'm still concerned for the well-being of my pack. Tell me why you've sought us out, and explain to me why I shouldn't give them the command to rip out your throats.
We're putting together a force to destroy the gnolls and the being that is creating them. Mm-hmm. We would be honored if you would lend your pack strength to our cause.
Our pack does seek glory, but we do not play well with others. Those fatheads that cower in the grove underneath the druid's protection, they are of little interest to us. We are not interested in helping them.
So you're just going to sit back and let them do all the heavy lifting? Because they're coming with us.
The wolf
glory shall be theirs!
Our pack has already been pushed out of its territory by Nilzen's filthy gnolls. We are considering moving westward, where there are fewer humans and fewer necromancers, hopefully.
Who is the dog now, then, if you retreat with your tail between your legs?
He snarls at you. I've watched too many of my brothers and sisters die fighting Nilzen and his snarling beasts to just turn around midstream while we're making a good time on our retreat.
I don't know what use we might have if they are such cowardly dogs.
Maybe we did misjudge them. It's almost like they don't want to take vengeance for their fallen packmates.
We have strength with the were-tigers, the were-boars, and the were-bears. We were wrong coming here.
Are you guys rolling charisma to try and dislodge him from his position?
I'm sure
they're just as strong as these werewolves anyway.
I think your guys' assistance is enough to grant advantage to whoever wants to roll.
Okay, because I just rolled a 19 plus 8, 27.
That's pretty extraordinary. And so he scratches his head, and his disposition moves from unfriendly to helpful. Yeah, he says. He tells you that if he has the backup of a larger force, then you can possibly make use of his pack. But the rest of the werewolves are further out westward. If you want their help, you're going to need to be a little bit more persuasive than that. You've got the seven of us here, but we can only be of so much use.
How much further west are they?
Not extraordinarily far, but we would be able to sniff them out because we know their trails and we know their destinations.
Are you saying they won't come to your call, or that we'll have to convince them separately that you exist as different cells, different packs?
Yeah. Exactly. We are different packs, and we do not stand as a monolith. There is squabbling and fighting amongst our number. So if you wanted to get the rest of you, wanted to unify the werewolf tribes, we would need to go talk to the elder chieftains.
Yes. How many of them are there?
There are four elder chieftains that we can go and collect. The nearest one is less than 2 days' travel from here.
Can you send your pack to collect the elders? Meet here as a moot?
Yes, but it will be a crapshoot as far as whether we can rein in any more additional support for you. If you guys come with us, then there is a possibility that we can have a larger chance of convincing more to rally to your cause.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Do we want to split the party? go one per elder and see if we can convince them, or do we want to just go one by one and see what they can do?
Heirs, too, since we have two people with decent charisma.
Yeah, I think myself and Gemma
should. Ari's okay, burning bridges, whatever. That's what she does.
Me and someone, and Gemma and someone.
Yeah.
And we'll cover more ground that way.
So you guys are doubling down on the path of the wolf.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, we are. I think we can manage to persuade them.
Mm-hmm.
After all, Gemma, you should also point out that once Nilsen is wiped out, who else is going to be the most powerful horse in this area if not the wolf pack? Mm-hmm. It'd be a nice way to set themselves up.
We don't want those stupid bears to take that territory. You make a good point.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Give it to those. Like big furry philosophers.
Or even worse, those stupid rats.
That's actually a good point. If you don't help us, we will have to turn to the rats, and we haven't yet, but sure, that's vital territory.
That's not going to look good. probably have to go into the city again to talk to their elders.
Sorry, we already have this guy, but it's good to, you know, I think that I should go with Thusk, and okay. So that there's a spellcaster and a melee in each group.
Okay. I'm sorry, then, Gemma.
Can okay. you heal, though? Maybe you should...
Can we what?
Can either of you heal?
Oh, no, huh?
I'm fine.
That's all right. We'll make it.
Okay.
So it is agreed, then. You will travel with my pack to the west, and we will seek out the elders.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, time is of the essence. It seems Nilzen is already setting his plans into motion. Mm-hmm. If we don't act quickly, there won't be much left to recover.
We should move as quickly as possible, yes. But I think this will be worth it.
Okay. So you will accompany us, then. We will show you the path.
Yes.
Yeah, we tell them we want to split up in two. Is that all right?
Oh, where will the other two go?
We want to split up. I mean, you said there was four elders. Is it best to... There are four elders and not all in one place, are they?
No, they are not all in one place. We would seek them out one at a time because... Because they are spread out over some distance.
Yeah, I think that it would be best if we sent you and two of your packmates with these two and the rest of them with us and kind of like separate us by how we're talked.
That way we can reach the elders more quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Time is of the essence.
Well, our pack will not split. So if two of you were to leave, you'd be striking out on your own to find them on your own. While my pack will move as a unit.
Mm-hmm. Jesse, what do you and Gemma think about going to that side? Because I don't think I have survival, nor does John.
Nope.
So the two of us would go alone.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to risk it, or?
Hey, you guys both have healing.
That's a terrible thing to fall back on. Maybe we should just stick together.
I like the idea of doubling down. I'm not entirely opposed to it. I'm just
doubling down on the wolf path demands the full resources of the party. Each of the wolf leaders will request some service of you in exchange for them calling in the lesser packs. Underneath their banner.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, one thing we could do... Is there one among them whose pack is largest?
All four of them are of relatively equal power, but all of the packs underneath of them vary in the size and power of their packs.
Is there one of those leaders who has the most...
What's most bang for our buck?
Yeah, the strongest warriors at his disposal.
The strongest werewolf depends on which werewolf you ask. Unfortunately.
We're asking you.
My pack is strongest. We think as one mind, and we run as one pack. Other werewolves, they are fractious and at odds with each other. Our pack has solidarity.
It would not surprise me if amongst all seven of you there was one mind.
you watch your joke go right over his head.
Are there any spellcasters among the werewolves?
We are not spellcasters. We are warriors.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we'll take the strongest path.
So. All right, let's just go to one of them then. I just figured it was best to try to, you know, put us up and figure it out.
It was worth a shot. Yeah.
Each of the elders will have a task that may require all of your talents in order to satisfy them. They are not used to having to deal with dogs of Agartha.
I feel like we probably don't have the time if Nilzen is already.
Mm-hmm.
Mobilize his plans.
Yeah. It might be
Perhaps, yeah, can we send you as our emissary to try to convince them? Yeah, I have another short sword you could probably give, or...
Yes, it is. If you send us, I can promise that at least one of the elders will join to our cause and come with us back to Agartha. I can promise that much. But mm-hmm. the other three, it's a crapshoot.
Oh, so you're saying that if we go with you, we can possibly get more than just the one?
Yes. Right. If you double down on the path of the wolf, then you can possibly get all four.
But if we wanted to, we could use this moment right now to say, okay, we get one and plus one of your elders, and then we can go try to seek out the were-rats.
We don't have too much time.
Yeah, I'd say either we just do it, just, you know, go and try to get all of as much as we can, or we just say, cool, get the one elder you can, and let's get back to, you know, securing the everything else.
With regards to time, your guys' nemesises in this game are playing out strategies that take weeks, months, years in order to enact. Like, Typhos's plan is meant to take place over years of time. So you guys are making really tight tactical decisions, and you might think that you're more tied up for time than you actually are, because your enemies are playing the long game.
Sure. What do you guys feel?
How many wolves does each pack leader have on call, average?
Between 4 and 12.
Okay.
For each
pack. We should go and try and get all four.
Alright.
I think so. Anyway, that'll net us at least 4 dozen total, which matches the strength of the boars. And then plus the tigers and the bears.
And one werewolf is worth many boars.
Exactly. So I think it's worth it.
Rolling her eyes.
I think it'd be worth it to go.
Okay.
Alright.
then you guys embark on the path of the wolf. And as you guys run with the wolves for a couple of days, and you eat their food, and you travel as they do, and you immediately become introduced to each member of the pack, who each has their own unique backstory and strange cultural origin and whatnot. They lead you out into the countryside, and you're filled with a bit of despair as you can see signs of warring amongst some of the werewolf tribes. You come across bodies that are littered with wounds as conflict between a couple of the packs have clearly turned bloody. And you can sense that your first encounter down the path of the werewolf is going to involve a bit of diplomacy as you try to... as you try to control this conflict amongst their number.
Oh, boy.
So I'm setting you guys up for the next leg of the journey, which will involve choosing a side in the path of the wolf.
If these wolves knew their true place, one pack does never fight another. Werewolves have become too human.
Don't tell them that.
Yeah, the minor werewolf chieftain, the guy who you gave the great sword to, he looks down piteously at his slain cousin, and he says, you know, this is the extent of Typhos's hopelessness and Nilzen's destructive power. It's turned us into fleeing beasts, savage beasts killing one another. It's the highest crime for werewolves to draw each other's blood, as he looks down and performs funeral rites over his fallen cousin.
However, will you have enough soldiers for the apocalypse if you kill each other?
He stands silently, a single tear rolls into the fur below his cheek.
Yeah, As you men of Agartha, men and women of Agartha, can see that he's robbed us of our honor and of our reason. It is It is a horrible turn of events what we are about to discover. And so maybe what we need right now is some outside help. But don't tell any of the other werewolves that I said that, or I'll kill you.
Should not have said that.
Should not have said that.
All right, so is that where we're ending right now? Is that what you're saying?
I think that it's a really good, it's an ideal spot to end. It ends on kind of a cliffhanger and setting up for the drama of the next session. Right. We can't get much done with the next 10 minutes. It lets you see to all of your obligations for the rest of the day.
Yeah, that's awesome. Oh, no, I can't. I have floor meetings at 4 o'clock, and then we're going to...
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Suicide squad as a staff, like a whole res life staff with all the RAs at 7, so... Nope, there's... I can't get out of it. I have to shower and get dressed and...
Yeah.
Do things.
Yeah, I have some things that I need to take care of today before the week gets started as well. So we can call it here for today. And can we play this again next weekend? What do you guys say?
Sure. Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Margaret's gonna be around. I'm gonna be gone for 4 weeks.
Oh God damn it! I wanted to set you up as the pack leader. Sardin is a wear anything a certain number of times per day. It'd be perfect.
As we begin to run with their pack, I wild shape into a wolf and just refuse to come back out.
It's actually interesting. Lycanthropy can't affect you, I don't think.
Really? Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah, I think you're immune to it because you're already a shape changer. I'd have to check that out, though.
I think that's true.
Well, plus I haven't decided whether it goes off of the classical D&D rules for lycanthropy or if I'll meld the mythology from Werewolf the Apocalypse or not. Mm-hmm. So I have some ironing out to do for this next segment of the adventure because I didn't expect you guys to go this far down the naturalist path of quest lines that I had. I have all kinds of dungeons and shit inside the city and inside the Crystal Palace and stuff with Typhos. And it's like I had all this shit plan is like, oh no, we want to go play in the forest.
Sorry. Like, oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
Nothing wrong with that.
Well, no, but that's the intended design that I had for this campaign is that it's more of a sandbox terrain for you guys to be able to experiment with different play styles and create your own story out of it, not just the story that I have planned. So this is really cool because it's really expanding the world outside of Agartha now. So I'm going to have to iron out some of that stuff and add some detail in.
Nice. Mm-hmm. All righty. Yeah, that's fun.
Margaret will be around, so I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I will not be.
What was that, Jesse? I didn't catch you.
Margaret will be around, so you guys should play without me.
Okay. Where are you going for the next 4 weeks?
I'm going to be in
China
for a month.
Where?
Shanghai.
Oh, Shanghai? Oh, nice. I enjoyed it. It's a nice
city. That's awesome.
Yeah,
that is awesome. I'm jealous.
That'll be different.
No, it is a beautiful city. Yeah, you're going to love it. It's very crowded.
Or described it as New York on steroids. So.
It is. It's very, very, very crowded. Oh, you know what they have, though? A lot of places have rooftop gardens in Shanghai. I don't know why, but it's beautiful. Yeah.
Where should he eat, John? Do you have any, like, restaurant suggestions?
Things I don't know. I was there for, like, a day and a half. I got deathly sick, and we had to leave.
All right, so, don't eat in Shanghai.
That's... Don't eat street food. Yeah. Be careful of the street food.
Start early with the street food. Build up a tolerance. First thing you eat, you just, like, dip your hand into the cart and just be, this is mine. And
oh, God.
Prepare your stomach.
Choose a tiny, dirty alley, a place that has as little light as possible, and look for the guy over a suspicious fire. Yeah. It'd be perfect.
Start looking at lamp.
Now, what are you going to Shanghai for?
Work.
No, fair enough. State secret stuff.
No, not really. There was, like, a detailed opportunity I applied to, so.
Oh, okay.
4 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Nice.
Well, We'll play more of the Protectors of Agartha storyline, but we'll rotate in other stuff so that you won't be far removed from it, because I'm sure that they're going to need Sardune for it. You have a few integral pieces of equipment that make you an indispensable member of the party. That's why I highly resisted the idea of you guys splitting the party. It's like, no, you guys will get fucked by anything that I have planned if you split the party.
Maybe. We're very, resourceful.
Well, like that Revenant fight, for example, was me not wanting to overwhelm you guys with a too hard of a fight right out of the bat, as you're coming in out of retirement or what have you. So that was only meant to wet your whistle.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we're very resourceful. Next time, I'll just string them up right at the beginning of the fight.
Just tie them up one at a time. Chop all their arms off. Yeah. That'd be perfect.
Boom. Done.
Every
time we have to like incapacitate and capture one.
Yeah.
Well, I really love playing with you guys because when I open up options to you guys, you immediately open it up further and further. Like with my other groups I story tell for, I give them a whole bunch of options and it's just immediate group paralysis. Mm-hmm. It's like, what is the most lowest common denominator action we can do? Let's kick in the door and kill everyone.
Yeah. It gets boring after a while.
Yeah, that's like I want to play Star Wars.
We'll play again next week. And
yeah.
If you feel the urge, Jesse, you can tune in at like 1 a.m. from Shanghai. We'll be playing.
We
should have reliable internet.
I don't know yet.
Yeah, okay. We'll see, so. And it would be great if you could join us from Shanghai if you could spare the time, mm-hmm. and we had the connection.
The problem is it's 12 hours difference, so it's going to be the middle of the night.
It's a what hour difference?
12.
12. Yeah.
Yeah.
We'd have to play.
I think that would only work if we played in the morning. You played in the evening until midnightish, but midnightish on Sunday. Would it be midnightish on Sunday or midnightish on Saturday?
It's 12 hours ahead, so if we played at like 8 p.m. Saturday, you guys' time, it would be 8 a.m. my time.
Uh-huh. we might be able to make something like that work.
That would be difficult.
you'd have to keep us informed and kind of tell us what your schedule allows and what your internet allows, if anything.
Yeah, I'll figure out what the internet's like and see how it goes.
All right.
Well,
thanks for DMing and
have
a good day, everybody.
I'll see you guys later.
Oh, don't go see Sausage Party. Avoid that if you can.
What? Sausage? Yeah. What?
Why would anyone see it?
I already know that's awful from the title.
Yep. I knew it was awful before I walked in, and then everyone was going, and I'm like, I'm just going to be a part of the group. And felt so, like, terrible because, like, I didn't find it funny at all. Like, everyone in the crowd is laughing, and it's like, oh, you guys are all sheep. There were some, like, redeeming moments, but it was also just like, goddamn.
You're watching the end of Western culture happen in front of you.
Yeah, it's fun. It's a lot of fun. It's just maybe the rise of something new. Who knows? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, have a good one, everyone. Later.
I had a whole lot of fun, you guys.
Yeah,
have a good one.
Yeah.
Sure. Peace.
See you guys next week.
Bye.
Next week.